Try this again.
You're talking to the Rolex wearing, diamond ring wearing, kiss stealing, woo, wheeling dealing, limousine riding, jet flying, son of a gun, and I'm having a hard time holding these alligators down. Woo!
We'll do it live! Fuck it! Halfway.
I don't take no shit from anyone.
You are so dumb. You are really dumb. For real.
Welcome to prime time, bitch.
You got some big testicles to pull this off, bro.
English, motherfucker, do you speak it?
I don't take no shit from anyone.
You are so dumb.
English, motherfucker, do you speak it?
I don't take no shit from anyone.
English, motherfucker, do you speak it?
I don't take no shit from anyone.
English, motherfucker, do you speak it?
You are really dumb.
English, motherfucker, do you speak it?
I don't take no shit from anyone.
English, motherfucker, do you speak it?
Yeah, the FooL and Friends, ladies and gentlemen.
What's up?
Finally.
Shut up!
Hour later.
Hey, there I am.
It was Sergio.
Got an engineer that just fucking shits all over the show.
Wow.
Hashtag free to FooL and Friends.
I'm calling out Sergio myself.
I had to restart this three times to get your show running. And
FooL.
Just blaming me?
Hashtag free to FooL.
Jeez.
I'm calling out this
hashtag
man.
Hashtag freedom for the FooL. Hashtag need a new manager. Hashtag need a new engineer.
Hashtag golden monkey.
Jesus Christ.
You are so dumb. You are really dumb.
Any engineer's looking for a job.
He's a guy that responds with GIFs in a thread.
For real, that's me. All day. We're here tonight. If y'all been tuning in, we got Uncut Gems, we have Bad Education, and we have Road to Perdition. It's going to be good reviews, but we have some news articles.
No, it's not.
to get into. First off, the anniversary is coming around the corner. August this year. Scott Pilgrim versus the World.
Hey.
10 years already.
10 years. We mentioned this on the last episode, but there's been some news that there could be an anime project on the way. I'm pretty dope. Happy about that dopeness there. I'm pretty dope with the dopeness. Dope, happy, dope.
Come on, get dope with the dopeness.
Get dope with the dopeness. Right?
Get down with the dopeness.
I love Jomer's attempt there. The feeble
get
attempt.
Get down with the dopeness.
So I'm just cupping up a loogie.
But yeah, it didn't do well when it initially came out in the box office. I'm proud to say I was one of the few people that actually saw it in theaters, like when it dropped that weekend.
I saw it twice.
Yeah, I was like, when I saw the trailer, I was like, yo, I'm going to check that out. Like,
you know what it was,
it's
bro?
It's
going to
be
that
a fucking sleeper. And it was cult following, like afterwards, like the shit made up for it. And now, like, he's even potentially going to expand, I guess, throughout the anime, make it even possibly more based on the
books.
Was
it released during, like, a time where other big movies were coming out, though?
Mm-hmm.
That's probably why it got buried, then.
Well, the thing was is that it also had, I think, a, like, early winter release, which is, you know, that's where, like, shit goes to burn off. Mm-hmm. And then a lot of people didn't know that they had a manga behind this or anything like that. So that's why no one really paid any attention to it back
apparently
in the day.
Apparently there's a lot of, like, story they left out.
Yeah, they did, yeah.
And there was they have material. That they made.
That beat 'em up was amazing.
With one of the best video game soundtracks I've ever heard.
Yes. Yeah, I had
even the movie had some dope music.
Oh, it was fantastic.
Yeah. No, and that was, I think, if I'm not mistaken, Beck. Beck was one of the...
No shit.
He was, yeah.
All right.
He was one of the bigger artists on there.
One of the most underrated artists ever, by the way.
Yeah.
My opinion.
I mean, he plays, what, like 20
he's
fucking
very
instruments?
Eclectic. I like him a lot.
It's just like, you don't know where he's coming from. Like, one project to the next is going to be, like, depends on his moves. Like,
right. Facts.
And to me, that's fucking awesome, because most people, like, get in a groove, and they get in a formula. And he's anti-formula.
People think of Beck, they think of, like, Devil's Haircut and what's the other big hit from that album, Odelay?
Loser.
That's Mellow Goldfield, but either way, you think of those songs, he's so much more than that.
Yep. For sure.
Yeah, and I think even Michael Cera actually played bass on some of the songs that were for the Sex Bombs, like Threshold, which should have been playing a long time ago, but my engineer's trash. So it is what it is.
Lobbing grenades back and forth.
I even slowly said let me Scott be honest. Pilgrim versus the World for him to be like, oh yeah, let me hit the button.
Look, but I'm not gonna. Bo's not gonna dunk at you as hard as I'm gonna dunk on this fucking movie he made me see. So
which one?
I'll get there.
He really doesn't like Uncut Gems a lot.
Fuck
wow,
that movie.
Are you kidding?
Who doesn't like Uncut
Fuck
Gems?
Okay, that well, movie. Shit.
Yeah,
I don't even have a retort.
Exactly. You're by yourself on this one.
I don't give a shit, dude. This is my hill to die on.
You can try to jump on me, but that's okay.
So like, which one you want? You never told me what song.
No, I told you before the show. You forgot.
You never told me the song.
Yeah.
He said, I got the whole soundtrack in there.
And I said, Threshold.
I played this song.
Right.
Didn't say anything else.
Which is, what song is this, guys?
Threshold.
This is exactly. This is what I told him.
It's coming in.
Do you want to see what it says on the screen? It says, we are Sex Bob Omb. It doesn't say anything about Threshold.
Yeah. Hey, you're in the porn soldier.
So thanks. Thanks for playing. Thanks for
you
playing.
Want to look it up?
I can look it up. I can tell you what it says right there in the damn soundtrack folder that you gave me. Did I download it? No. You gave it to me.
This was supposed to be an awesome moment for Bo, and now it's like sad.
No, it's not. It's
you ruined the good surprise.
Hey, I'm just trying to do a show. I mean, I can't. I can only do so much. What do you want from me, guys? What do you want from me? What do you guys want from me? What do you want?
Pick a better fucking movie for starters.
You're the only one that didn't like it.
I know. I'm okay with that.
How though?
I've been on.
You know how like some things are like you just they're not even worth the response.
Yeah,
that's how I feel about it.
Right. Like that's why I didn't respond.
It's like, Uncut Jim sucks.
In
I'm
the
like
chat earlier. Okay.
Yeah, that's like your opinion, man.
But all right, you can cut the music now. It's.
The moment's just passed.
Yeah, you ruined it.
You asked for this.
So, on to something that I think we all can agree on that hopefully may go well if done right is the Ninja Turtles. I mean,
that's Threshold. Just wait, saying,
they're version. Both Threshold.
No, they're not.
Okay. Anyways,
go ahead.
Return of the Ooze.
So apparently Seth Rogen's involved.
Okay,
which really? Is cool. That's cool. In my opinion,
They're also going with cartoon like CGI, which I'm okay with as well. Because
the
CGI TMT movie that came out, that I watched that was surprisingly good.
Yeah,
I thought
that
so
one,
too.
That one was weird. Really good. Yeah.
Yeah. And
I was expecting trash, and it was like pretty above average.
Okay. Yeah,
and honestly, above average.
Well, and that's how I felt about the bombs that were Michael Bay's.
Yeah,
like the first one was trash. The second one actually had stupid good potential, and I'm sad that the first one sucked so bad because the second one was ultimately like, yeah, we tried, but like. Krang looked fucking dope.
I didn't see the second one.
I didn't bother with the second
one.
Dude,
the second one's worth watching because they got Bebop, Rocksteady, and Krang.
Mm-hmm.
They were making Baxter.
Mm-hmm.
Baxter was happening. I was like, yo, this is what's supposed to happen. Yo, Krang looked like fucking Krang.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And they were bringing in the Technodrome.
Mm-hmm.
Like, oh, this is funny. How they were supposed to do it. And because he's a dumbass and didn't do that from the get-go... Like, the second movie should have been the first movie.
I mean, I'm just convinced that anything that Michael Bay touches now turns to shit, so...
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I agree, 100%.
But he's got some good ones under his belt.
Which ones?
The Rock.
The Rock true. Is good.
That actually had more Michael Bay, and I forgot the guy, Simpson. But there was more collaboration between Bay, Bruckheimer, and Simpson back then. That's why that movie was good.
But still.
And Bruckheimer's pretty solid, too.
Bad Boys. When I was a kid, I loved Bad Boys.
Oh, yeah,
looking back
Bad
on
Boys.
It, I want to rewatch it,
okay,
honestly.
I'll give you Bad Boy 2.
Yeah.
But that was more
both.
Action, yeah.
I thought both. Yeah. I mean, they had their strengths. And trust me, I don't like Michael Bay. But I thought it was something that came later in his career. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
But he did Pain and Gain, which was pretty funny.
Mm-hmm. Yo, Pain and Gain. Yes.
I mean... So he's got. I feel like he's one of those guys. Like
but the thing is,
if he could just like channel his shit right, but
instead of
Bayhem,
but dude, I feel like
Bayhem, Bayhem.
Sometimes, well, here's the sometimes thing. I feel like he just like gets too in the like too off the rails.
It's a Bayhem. That's what it is.
Honestly, I think we're giving him too much credit for Pain and Gain because he took basically a real story.
Yeah.
And threw it on the screen.
A really dark, still, like, fucked up story and made
because
it funny.
The fact of the matter is, the fact that they have to flash it on the screen,
yeah.
like halfway, maybe three quarters through the movie, that this is based on a true story. Yeah. I was like, yo,
but dude,
yeah, like,
but it's also,
I haven't, nah,
but
I
it's
haven't.
Also his direction. It's not like his movies are shot really well. The acting comes out like everything you want a director to do, where you want everything to come together properly. Like he can make it happen.
Yeah,
he just does it. Less often than he does, or less often than he should.
Right. He doesn't hit as much as he has, like, or he could have. You know,
you just do what I did.
Right. You know.
We know talk.
He's
well.
A lot misses. He missed lots. He no hit good.
He missed lots. Sometimes good.
He threw
sometimes okay. Sometimes okay.
He said like Charlie from It's Always Sunny.
Me use less words, still get the same result.
Make good point.
Oh, Kevin from The Office, right? Yeah. That's one of my favorite clips of that show. Yeah. It's funny, I haven't watched that show in full, but I see clips all the time.
Oh, God.
The chili clip is the best.
There's so many of the best moments.
No,
though.
Dude, but really Kevin, is. For Kevin, the chili clip
yeah,
is the best.
Kevin specifically, yeah.
Did you see the one? Did you see the one where they took that and they put it next to Trump, where he's like, "I know speak well, but I get point across or some shit." It's like Trump yelling at a rally, and
dude, too hilarious. But I got Speaking of reboots / throwbacks, I saw this and it stuck in my eye. Because shout out to my brother Alf, he had the haircut from the kid from the original Never Ending Story. Number one,
yeah.
The first one, the solid bowl cut that was Alf was rocking that shit. I had that shit at one time. I'm having it almost now with all this going on under the hat. But the chick, the queen, she's attached to a film with Sean Astin. And Christopher Lloyd.
Okay.
And it's a throwback to, and it's
described. Wait, I read something about this.
As an homage to the lo-fi fantasy films of the 80s.
All right.
So, and also, the Jim Henson Creature Shop will be making puppets for us.
Sold.
Wow.
Dope.
Yeah. That's when I saw all that together in one headline. I'm like, well, shit.
I love Christopher Lloyd.
Clickbait or not, I'm looking at this. So, I'm interested to see where they go with that. But apparently, it's going to be, let me see here. It's a comic adventure, Man and Witch, is what they're calling it, I guess. So, I mean, to have her and, of course, Sean Astin, I mean, fucking Rudy, fucking Samwise, and he was also Sam on fucking Stranger Things, first season.
R.I.P.
Right?
He's a pretty underrated actor.
He is. He doesn't get enough credit.
And Encino Man was his best work. Fight me.
He was in that.
Wait. Wasn't he one of the Goonies?
Holy shit. Yeah.
He was one of the Goonies.
He was like
Encino
him
Man.
Think about it. Think about this. Samwise and Thanos were in the same movie.
Yeah. Right?
Wow.
Yo, and shout out to Josh Brolin. He's done some fucking great films. That's like, true. Thanos being one of his
No Country
roles.
For Old Men.
Yeah.
Where'd you get that gun?
Actor, man.
Get in place.
Dude, and True Grit. True Grit was great.
Shout out to the pirate gang. He
facts.
Was
facts. And one last one that I thought was pretty hilarious. Right, thank you for this one.
What is it?
Matter of fact, here, you read it. I'm going to let you read this one.
Jason Momoa set the stars ripped Frosty the Snowman. Upcoming film.
Bro, is Hallmark somehow attached to this? Because that has Hallmark.
They have to be, right? Like, it has to be a Hallmark movie.
Fucking
right?
Hell.
That was the first one I sent, too, wasn't it?
It was one. No, it was like the
big,
second or third, but it was.
The Mirage was like the first
dude.
One. You have to talk about this.
This shit, like. Like, now, granted, I haven't read through the article, just the headline, because I was done after the headline. I was like, wait. Scratch this shit. But. Where can you do, like, is he going to be like, what, like Frosty the Snowman on roids? Like,
I think it's animated, actually.
That, I mean, but yeah. Even so, if he's going to be a ripped snowman, like, I swear to God, there better be a fucking song or two in this fucking movie.
It's just going to be funny hearing his fucking voice.
Yeah.
Ripped Frosty the Snowman.
Coming out of Frosty.
It's going to be 20 degrees below zero, and this motherfucker's going to be on with a shirt off and shit.
Then we can have a nice discussion. Who is the best snowman, Jason Momoa or Bruce Willis?
Oh, and Michael Keaton.
Right, Michael Keaton, right?
Yeah.
What about Josh Gad?
Oh, shit.
That's
yeah.
The best snowman.
That's right. Fucking Frozen. Yeah. True.
I have to say, I hate that fucking character. He's what, creepy as fuck.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of those films.
No, he's creepy. Like, I feel like if he could drink Elsa's bathwater, he would. And I feel like...
I mean...
Just, he's a snowman, though. He would just absorb it.
Exactly. That's true. But even weirder. You know. All
right.
Even creepier, right?
Oh, my God. He takes off his care nose, just stirs it around a bit, pops in, and just absorbs it.
Yeah, like, Frozen just took a totally different turn, bro. Like, you could, like, and things, you know how they take trailers and they put, like, they change the mood and the ambiance with the music and everything, and they turn it to, like, Forrest Gump got turned into, like, a psycho thriller?
Yes, yes.
That's one of my favorite mix-ups right there. But imagine that, like, Frozen taking the snowman, Olaf, and make him into, like, a serial killer.
I have to say, other than...
Yeah, right?
Other than, like, three or four songs, Frozen, overrated as fuck.
Yeah.
Both of them. Fuck you, Frozen.
I still haven't seen it.
I don't know what I'm saying.
I haven't either. I'm with Chuck on this one. I've never seen it. The most I know about it was thanks to Kingdom Hearts 3.
There you go.
Piece of shit.
That game. Ah, fuck.
But.
That game was like 50% cutscenes.
Is that why it dropped down to 20 bucks like in a matter of 2 months?
Like, honestly, combat great. The visuals great. But like the presentation, the worlds were small as fuck compared to the previous two games. Mm. And it was just cutscene after cutscene after cutscene. It's like, bitch, if I wanted to watch the movie, I would. Like,
funny thing about
I got Disney Plus, motherfucker. Like,
funny thing about Kingdom Hearts, though, I haven't played any of them. Mm. But one of my bands used to be called Hollow Bastion back in the day, years ago.
Interesting.
Mm.
That's where they got it from. But yeah,
very nice, very nice. I like that. That's pretty dope, actually. Did you guys play the song from Hollow Bastion at least?
Actually, we opened up our set with like a slowed down clip of that main character, the kid talking. Mm. I don't remember what it said, but we opened every time with that. Just played slowed down.
I think that would have been dope if y'all had at least that song, you know, from that stage, from the level or whatever. But yeah,
could have.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to get into we're going in hot to Uncut Gems because we have one person in this room who really had a bad time. Like, I think this was one of my moments.
I love the captions.
Right?
You have captions?
I'm like watching the captions like,
Hollow Baskin.
Goddamn Hollow Baskin.
It's fucking hilarious. It's that bitch Hollow Baskins.
Hollow Baskin Robin.
Hollow Baskin.
Dude, I've been sitting like over and over, I look over and I'm like, what the fuck is it saying?
You're just tuning in. We're laughing at the captions. So bring up the captions on your screen. All right. So we're going to jump into this Uncut Gems. I picked it because we had mentioned wanting to review it when it first got like released and everything.
Who has the best phone? Who has the audio up on their phone, by the way?
Yeah, somebody's got to mute their phone.
Not me.
That might be me, actually. That's probably me. That is
yep.
me. That is me. Noob. Uncut Gems was my pick. Adam Sandler is a star. It's one of his few serious dramatic roles. He plays a diamond fucking
dealer,
enthusiast, fucking addict. Like, he was all over the place. It is in what? Long Island, right?
What? Where he lives or where? Yeah, he lives in Long Island and then he operates out of Manhattan.
Okay. So he has his own little shop, and it's one of those. It's kind of gave me one of those. Fuck, his name escapes me right now. But like Snatch and all them,
Guy Ritchie.
A little bit in the sense of how
don't slander
like
his name like that.
No, the idea of how
it would be way funnier. If
it's No, the movie would have been even better if it was done by Guy Ritchie because it seemed like one of his where a focal
Wait, Uncut
point.
Gems?
Yeah,
no,
his focal point. Can I finish?
I'm sorry.
His focal point.
I'm a Guy Ritchie fan. Clearly.
Was a object of some sort, like in Snatch the Diamond, Rock and Roller the painting.
Yeah.
So with Uncut Gems, the focus is the giant block. You know,
the opal
that brings so much trouble. You know, that's my equation to it. Nowhere near a Guy Ritchie film, but it has that focal point. Okay? Is that okay?
No, it's not
Can
okay.
I have that opinion?
Dude, this movie is a gem.
It is a gem.
It's an uncut gem.
And on its own, and it's because of that kinetic energy that the Safdie brothers bring that they brought in Good Time.
Right.
Same style.
Right, and I was going to say that, too.
Yeah.
I was going to bring that up.
Honestly, if it was a Guy Ritchie movie, I think it would be like 10 notches lower, honestly, personally.
Well, yeah, and I just said that.
Yeah. Okay.
God damn it, guys. Okay. Jesus.
It's not your day, Bo. We're coming after you.
Apparently not. Like, can I have my show? Can I have my show?
I fucked up, Bo. I fucked up.
I literally just said what you said.
Hey, I'm not him. I'll admit it. All
right? God damn it. God, that was the only equation tonight. Was the block, the gem, opal. That's it.
Okay.
That was his Guy Ritchie-ness. Everything else, no, it wasn't. Guy Ritchie's 10 times better and could have took this.
Thank you.
And made it great, too.
Right.
In its own right. And it's a good movie in its own right. It's contrary to what you believe. Adam Sandler won. No hibbity doobities, no shoobity floobities. Like, he nails it. All right.
No weird voices.
I was like, there's people like that were like, oh, it was too tense for you. Like, that's the whole point of the fucking movie. Like, if you like, you probably haven't watched Good Time. You would hate Good Time.
Mm-hmm.
You would hate
that.
Oh,
don't watch
movie.
Good Time.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But like,
or heaven knows what.
Yeah, yeah, and
the heroin addict. Yeah,
just like you mentioned, and I'm seeing a trend. A24, this is their
A24 is the best studio in my opinion by a mile.
Well, and this is their thing. Like, yeah, they have we like these type of movies in a sense. I've noticed, because
dude, they buy up the best movies at festivals, and they fucking like I trust, like, dude, every time I see go to watch a movie and then A24 comes up at the beginning, I'm like, I'm good.
Yeah, like I'm like, this is gonna be decent.
It's the only fucking one that I could say that about.
Yeah. And so Kevin Garnett shows up, fucking
The Weeknd.
And it's supposed to be before he was big. It was like
this is like 2012. Yeah.
Yeah.
So like he's big locally, but he's not like kind of, I don't know. He's not like a
he's
national.
He's up and coming. Yeah.
Like they're in a little club or whatever. Yeah.
Yeah. So Adam Sandler gets into some trouble. He has gambling problems. He ends up loaning to place a bet to then, it's just
robbing Peter to pay Paul type shit.
Right. Yeah. And it was a fucking wild ride. Like, because I enjoy Good Times, like, that's exactly what I was thinking the whole time. I was like, this honestly reminds
me.
It's
another character where it's like,
yeah,
he keeps putting himself in situations where he's like, why is he doing that?
How does
he get out?
Yeah. Exactly. And I'm just
an
like,
addictive, like, that's the thing too, is it's like, it puts you in that mind. It puts you right in his mind, because he can't not have a lifestyle.
He lives
like that.
On
right.
his impulses.
Like, exactly. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Dude, the second he's good and he gets the money from Kevin Garnett at the end, that's when you know. He's like, you know what?
Fuck it.
We're going to bet.
Yeah.
And he's like, fucking, and he calls her up. He's like, come over here right next door. I'm going to hand this off to you.
Yeah.
He's like, telling him what he's going to do. He's like, you're fucking crazy, man.
Well, even that, I was just like, yo, he's doing it.
Yeah.
Like, he's stalling these guys so he can give the cat.
What's
like,
weird,
this guy's fucking crazy.
What's weird, too, is you're rooting for him in a way. It's like,
yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Fuck.
I wasn't.
I was.
Right.
I mean, I wanted to, I don't know. You want to see him, because it's Adam Sandler, I think.
Right.
That's why this is the perfect role for Adam Sandler, because, like, anybody else playing it, you'd be like, this is a despicable human being, which he still is, but, like...
Right.
But there's something about Adam Sandler that makes him somewhat likable in a weird way.
The only time that I enjoyed the movie was when I saw that guy suffering. That was it.
Yeah. And, I mean, that's understandable.
That's suffering with what?
You kind of really
everything.
Hate him.
Oh, with everything.
Like, pretty much the whole movie? Yeah. Dude, like, he can't go anywhere without somebody coming up and being like, hey, man, you owe me this.
Yeah.
Dude, that one scene where... Oh, I lost myself.
We all lost, I think.
No, we're good.
No, all right. Myself.
So, the one scene where he's on the phone and he's like... He's picking up and it's Kevin Garnett's... That woman, the agent.
The agent, yeah.
There's an agent. And then his girlfriend calls. And then fucking...
the doctor calls, I think.
Yeah.
And then the guy... The doctor calls. And
the auction
guy from,
house.
The guy from...
Sorry to bother you.
Sorry to bother you. Yeah, that guy.
Damani.
Dude, Damani, yes. Damani's in there and he's fucking... Like, dude, and he's got people coming up, employees being like, dude, I'm not happy. And he's, like, kind of actively ignoring them and shit and fucking...
Is obsessing over the opal.
Like, he doesn't understand that, like, dude, if you just make these people around you happy...
Everything else will fall into place.
Yeah, but it's not his mentality. Like,
No.
He's very
self-destructive. Like, and that's the whole thing you see throughout the whole thing is him just self-destructing consistently throughout the whole fucking thing. And, like, shout out to him for pulling it off. Like, because obviously the bulk of Adam Sandler is comedy. We all know this. He has very few films that are serious.
Like Rain Over Me, he was actually really good in that.
Yeah. That one.
Punch Drunk Love.
Fuck that movie in the nicest of ways. Like, fuck that movie, man. That
shit. Movie's heavy.
Like, I remember seeing that Rain Over Me.
What's wrong with it?
It's just heavy, man.
It took place around 9/11, and it kind of plays a little bit off that, but it's really heavy.
It hits you, and you're just like.
I was just like, I thought it was fine.
Yeah, no, it's definitely, it was one of his darkest films, and it just was just like, yo, wow. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, honestly, look, it's not, definitely not one of the best films, but it's not bad at all. Like, it's a fucking ride from the beginning to end. Like, just the fights he gets in.
The whole movie's like a ticking time bomb.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and like, and that's one thing I liked about it, because, like...
It can only end the way it ends.
Captain Slowburn over here. Like, this is one of those movies where it was literally like...
From the jump.
Yeah, just like, oh, ah!
Dude, from the jump, it's in your face, like...
I'm like, shit,
fuck your sensibilities, bitch, we're going on a ride.
Get in the car, bitch! It's just like Good Time.
From,
like,
the jump, man.
Yeah, just like Good Time. That movie, dude, from the jump, you're like, yo, what the fuck am I watching?
You start at these mines in Africa. Which, yeah, there's some interesting commentary going on there.
Which
with,
that I thought yeah. it was going to be more about the Blood Diamonds than anything.
It kind of is like, you know, Kanye's Blood Diamonds the movie, like yeah. in a weird way. I mean, well, there's added elements, but like yeah,
right.
Like the thematically, it's a lot like that yeah. because this guy like he gets his thrills gambling and like right. wasting money basically.
And basically,
and these motherfuckers are dying over it. Over right. it, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. And they're Jewish black people.
Oy vey, yeah. brother.
So you huh?
Oy vey.
Yeah, but then you got Kevin Garnett who's black. And you got Adam Sandler, who's Jewish,
right?
Both, you know, vying after this fucking uncut gem,
right?
That or this opal that yeah. these people are dying over, fucking making, you know, pennies on the dollar for.
Yeah,
and so it's like, it's really interesting.
And according to his character, it was worth like how much?
It was,
like,
it was well to, be close to him.
To him, yeah.
To him, he was saying it was worth like
a million close.
Mills, like
yeah,
if not
was,
more.
He thought ridiculous. He was going to make millies,
but then
yeah.
other yeah. appraisers were like.
Well, even then, when the girl says, she's like, okay, oh, she's like, you brought the stone to me on Friday. Mm. And I was like, well, what about the original estimate? Yeah, well, if you had brought the stone to me sooner, then that other estimate would have been, or that appraisal right. would have been wrong. You gave us shorter time. This is what it's going to come out with. Either
night.
I pull it. Yeah, I was yeah. like, either I pull it or we sell it for what it is.
Yeah. Mm. And that the whole, like, him trying to control everything. Too.
Bro, when
yeah.
he's on the phone with her and, like, the secretary's there.
Yeah.
And he's fucking, like, his tonal shift changed where he's like, I'm going to work this. Okay. Yeah. Dude, you can see him think it, too, before he does it. Like, he's a great character, man, period. Yeah. I don't give a fuck.
Him, he grew up in New York, right, Adam Sandler?
Oh, yeah, he was Brooklyn? On Saturday Night
Live. No. He grew up, I think, in a suburb of Connecticut, but then he spent, like, his 20s. That's why he's, like, he's always, like, loving or dick-sucking on, like, the New England style, like, grow-ups and shit. That's why, because
I was just saying, like, he seems like he grew up around people like that, or at least yeah. was around people like that at yeah. one point, because he definitely kind of nailed that role.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
I mean, I think he came to Manhattan, I think, when he was, like, 19 or some shit like that. So that's how, especially living in Manhattan, back then it wasn't as expensive as it is now.
Right.
So then that's how he was able to make his dues, and he probably got exposed to that as well growing up, like, coming up
that's
and shit.
True. And by the way, about it, most of his movies are either New York or, like, that Massachusetts.
Yeah, like Massachusetts, kind of Connecticut, yeah. Rhode Island type shit. That's what it is. So.
True. Interesting choice to go for Grown Ups 8, you know what I mean?
Right. Yeah. Like, fuck Grown Ups 5. We're doing Uncut Gems. Now, he did. He honestly. Now, the one of the big things that was mentioned when the movie was announced was, like, a lot of people were like, yo, this is might want to be his, like, his runs, like, for a fucking Oscar and shit. And
he should have been nominated, bro. That's so
thank you. I was like, well, here's the thing. And that was my thing. I was like, nominated, probably win. Ah, that's a tough call.
I mean, I can see that.
Because there was a lot of good other still
you can make that argument for
the
anybody,
the problem
though.
With Adam Sandler, though, is I watch him in any role, and I still see Adam Sandler.
Right.
It's not like...
And that's the hard part. With
it's not like yeah. Gary Oldman, where I watch him, and I see him as his character.
Mm.
With Adam yeah. Sandler, like Johnny Depp, I see them as
but
themselves.
Dude, I see him
you know?
As Howard, man. I really do.
I didn't, though.
I do.
That's just Adam
because he
Sandler,
had the
though.
Teeth. The right. fake teeth. The false teeth or whatever. Or I don't know what they
like,
are.
Here's the thing.
But
I'm what's funny is, like, I agree with both of you because I'm like, part of me was like that, but then, like, halfway through the film, I'm like, that's fucking Howard.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? At first, I'm like, this is kind of
considering
Adam.
How big Adam Sandler is, dude, he's a worldwide name.
Yeah.
And, like, it's like Tom Cruise. Tom Cruise can't get away from that shit. Like, you might see him as Ethan Hunt, maybe, from Mission Impossible. But, like, still, you see Tom Cruise. Like,
right.
There's some people that
honestly,
they're just too big for their own good. They
I see him jumping on a couch every time now.
Well, like, Tom Cruise isn't very
all
big.
I see.
But I feel like Adam Sandler, dude, like as much as he could escape in a role, he did with Howard, in my opinion.
Yeah, I mean, this is probably one of his best roles for sure.
Yeah,
hands down. Like this is one of his top roles, that. If not his best.
I'm role. Gonna come
right. Like, yeah, he's so fucked up. All right, so for me, favorite scene. Honestly, was the when he was placing that final bet, like that right. shit, like that's when everything was like
when he was out the window
dude,
and
when
shit.
When he had
yeah.
them locked up and they set it up from the beginning, dude.
Yeah,
the beginning of the movie, they got like it's all fucking so hectic and shit. The movie, the way it's just, everything's coming at him all at once and shit, and like you have these people trying to get in, Kevin Garnett and his crew, and he's fucking, you know,
and then,
hit the buzzer, da da da.
Hey, like, G, stop leaning on the glass.
Yeah.
Yo, and the thing is, he told him like three fucking times, like, yep. "Hey, G, stop leaning on the glass."
He got lost in the fucking opal, and like he saw the universe, and
right.
then he goes to the glass.
Yes, and then he's like, "Yo, do you see that shit?" Oh god, but no, that part where he's basically getting shook down at this point by the dude he owes money to,
which is his brother-in-law.
Yeah, brother-in-law. That fucked me up too. His goons,
oh,
and then his goons turn, man. Fuck. But you look. The beginning of the game, the last game, like beginning of that whole scene.
The tip off, dude.
That I was like sitting there like, yo.
I remember being in the theater like, what if they just like say fuck the tip off?
Well, and the thing is, I think
as writers, I was weirdly rooting for him.
Yeah.
I was like, what the fuck am I rooting for this guy for? And if you look at his brother-in-law, like he's rooting for him too.
Yeah.
And like all the way up until the end, he's like.
Even at the end, he was like, you know what? Fuck it. Because even in his mind, he was like, yo, I just came up.
You know what the crazy part is? Adam Sandler, Howard, he would have done it.
Yeah.
Like, but if they called the bet off earlier.
Yeah.
He would have been fine.
Yeah.
And it's like, damn, there's some kind of weird intuition going on where he might actually have. If they hadn't fucked that whole thing.
Well, and that was a second sign, too, because remember in the beginning of the movie, he had to hit big.
That's what I'm talking about.
But that movie got took away.
Like, that part wouldn't even have happened if it wasn't for them calling off the bet.
Yeah, exactly.
And it's like, dude, he could have fucking just been riding it. But, like, he's one of those guys, he can't be happy with what he's got. You see his house and shit. Dude, he's fine, dude.
Two houses. His house and the apartment.
That apartment was so nice.
How much does that cost? You know how much that apartment would probably run in Manhattan? Probably about $20 million.
Holy shit, really?
Yeah.
That big of an apartment in Manhattan, $20 million, dude.
And the view they had?
Yep.
Yeah. It looked like a corner apartment, too.
Yep, exactly.
Yeah, his neighbor was the fucking dude from Good Times.
Yep.
Yeah.
Like, I was just like, yeah, so yeah, you're probably right. Like,
$20 million.
And he's in there talking about, I might hit it big with this opal. It's like, bro, you're fucking fine if you just play your cards right.
Yeah.
Like, you're not, like, I don't know.
He's too greedy, too much.
But
too
that's what makes him a great compulsive or a great character to watch, because it's like, what's this fucking guy going to do next, man?
Yeah, exactly.
It ends the only way it can end.
Right, and that scene, scene where he's doing that, where they're basically forcing him to call off the bet so he can get their money, and he's like, nah, fucking nope. I'm not doing it. I'm like, yo, wow. This guy's insane.
He's like, by the way, yeah, I got it on the game.
Yeah, it's fucking crazy. So that with all that involved, like Adam Sandler is one of his best films, hands down. I'm giving it a solid 8. Solid 8. And Red. Can I get somebody? Can somebody help me out?
Dude, I love the Safdie brothers and the way that they bring this. Like, there's a chaotic energy about all their movies, and they focus on these characters that are clearly troubled.
Yeah.
But they have the slimmest of little redeeming qualities about them.
Yeah.
They're human, and they fuck up, but they find a way to make them relatable in a weird way. Like, there's something about it, for me at least, I was rooting for Howard a little bit. Yeah, there's also that part of you that wants him to get his comeuppance. It's like, bro, you gotta learn something, bitch. But you don't want him to die, you know what I'm saying?
I did,
right?
I mean, well, it was the only way it could end. That's the way I put it. It's like, dude, you're like, you're going too far.
Yeah. You know?
And you're like, he's talking to these goons, like, he called his brother-in-law a pussy, like, he's going in the bathroom. He told this other guy, he's like, that looks like one of your boys on the TV, like that fat fuck there, he looks like one of your boys. It's like, dude, these are debt collectors that want that have no problem with killing you,
he's
man.
Just throwing gasoline on fires as he goes along.
Yeah.
And I will say, the one time I actually did legitimately kind of feel slightly bad was when they shook him down and threw him naked ass in the trunk. Take his underwear too.
I want those underwear. I want those underwear.
I don't know. Yo.
Again, I was only happy when this guy suffered, so to me that was like...
Right, okay. For me, I was like, that's the one time I truly did feel like, I mean, slightly
he's
bad.
He's truly a despicable character.
Yeah.
Dude, I mean, look how big of a fucking coward he is, that his wife fucking tried to make a fist at him and he flinched. You don't know if you remember that?
Mm-hmm.
When she had the missus.
Look at how everybody looks at him like...
She's like, I can't even look at you. If it was up to me, I'd never see you again. Yeah.
Dude, like the guy that worked with him and he went with Flawless.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I keep forgetting his name.
Yanni.
Dude, that motherfucker, he knew what he was. Like, you know, like, I mean, like, dude, Howard is one of those guys where, like, behind his back, everybody talks shit.
Right.
Everybody's like, fuck that guy. He's a piece of shit. And some of them to his face. But everybody knows he's a clown.
Yeah.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
But there's a weird part of it. Because it's Adam Sandler is how I think is what it is. I was rooting for him. There's a weird thing where it's like, dude, I want you to pull this off, but you need to get your life together, man.
Right?
Like, fuck, dude. Like, you're a piece of shit.
Yeah.
You know, but I don't know. I'm also a softy.
Right. That's understandable. I mean, it is what it is. What was your favorite scene?
It's got to be the end, man. Like, dude, when he has them, when, like, fate happens for him.
And the thing
the universe, so to speak, comes together. And, like, the fucking deal falls. And, like, he realizes, he's like, oh, I could lock these motherfuckers up right here. It's bulletproof, even.
Yeah.
And, like, you just, as an audience member, Like, the whole movie, you're fucking... Things are getting ramped up every second. And, like, it's really, like... The way I put it is, like, kinetic energy. These directors, man, they know how to fucking establish that. And they got you focused. Like, they can put you in his shoes where, like, he's trying to juggle all these things at one time. And, like... once it gets to that point where it's like, it's all here, it's all on the line. It either happens or it doesn't happen. And that's my favorite moment. I mean, like, I don't think it even comes close, man. Like, that's the best scene when he's sitting there rooting for it and the tip off happens and he looks over and, yeah.
That shit was...
You gonna cry, bro? It's okay.
Yeah.
No, I'm fine.
He's in his feelings.
No, I'm just thinking about how I felt.
Himself.
I'm thinking about how I felt the first
time. He's collecting
time I
himself.
No, I'm not crying, man.
Yeah.
But, what the fuck?
I'm not crying, bro.
I'm not crying. Why would I cry?
And you know what's crazy? It's like, part of me was in denial that whole time because I'm like, yeah, this is not going to end well. Like, this isn't going to end well at all. I'm like, but maybe... Just maybe.
So this is actually the first movie I took Yuri to go see.
Okay.
Aww.
And like, dude, when
shout out to her,
dude, when she was fucking, when she was watching the whole scene, I could see her like sitting forward and shit. Mm. And then when they come in and cap him, dude, she was like, "There's my partner."
Yeah. I think everybody was.
Yeah.
I know I was.
I was the only one that was like.
Yeah,
yeah, but I mean, not even like sad. It was just like, whoa,
wow.
Yeah,
I was torn because like I felt like he deserved it, but I felt bad at the same time.
Right?
Yeah, it's weird, dude. It's like, cause fuck, man, his kids. You know what's weird too is like, he's a self-centered piece of shit. Like he's a narcissist.
Yeah.
So like when he's talking to his daughter, and you know she comes out and gets a cake or whatever, and he's like, "I'm proud of you. I like what you did with the show or whatever." Like he's looking for a response from her. Like
she's like,
"I'm glad you're proud of me." Which is not how that works.
Yeah.
Like you gotta be, you know, like you're saying I'm
proud
of you. He's
looking for respect that he didn't earn.
Exactly. And that's his whole character.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Like his whole character is like, I gotta do more. Dude, like, dude, you're fine. Fucking chill. Actually develop relationships that aren't built around fucking screwing people over.
Yeah.
Like, sure. Yeah. like you're good, but he just was never satisfied. And there's something that there's something about that character I like really, really fucking love. But he's despicable at the same time.
True. Yeah, I agree.
Very factual. Yeah. What are you giving it?
Dude, for me, 9 points. I think I did this already. I recommended the show earlier on. I think I gave it a 9.8.
Okay.
I think it's fucking great. But I love Good Time just as much, too.
Right.
I recommended Good Time earlier as well.
Yeah. All right, Chuck.
Yeah. Chuckles.
I like this movie. It surprised me. Just because Adam Sandler did have more range, like everybody said, more so than anything else he's done, with the exception of a few other movies.
Mm.
It kind of keeps you guessing the entire time, like... The fuck is he doing with himself? Like, just making stupid decisions, like betting the money when he could have easily just paid off Kevin Garnett or paid off the people.
Arno, Arlo, I think. Yeah.
Arno still made a profit off of that, regardless. Yeah. Something like $60,000.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, 65. Yeah,
he could have just taken that and then maybe bet that if he wanted to.
Right,
but no, he had to be greedy and bet the whole thing, which in the end fucked him.
Well, it's like he can't just make a profit and then take what he gets and bet on it.
Right.
He's got to fucking get Garnett's ring, pawn it off immediately.
Right.
Like, what the fuck? Dude, I still remember the first time I saw that in
that,
the theater. I was like, holy shit!
Stupid decision after stupid decision.
Immediately.
He immediately starts walking.
He waited till he left and then he fucking bolted right after that.
Yeah. Which is fascinating that somebody could do that. I could never, I don't have the balls to do that.
Oh, hell no.
Yeah.
If I was holding Kevin Garnett's ring, I wouldn't take it to a pawn shop. Are you kidding me?
Yeah, that shit blew my mind.
I'd be like,
bro,
put this in the safest place possible. Like, And he's the total opposite. I'm going to pawn this shit off. I'll make it back. Don't worry. The fact he's got that mindset is just so...
Yeah. He even forgot to go and get it, so he had to buy it back anyway.
All, with a VIG involved and everything. I'm like, dude, man.
Yo, and then they're like, and you know, I'm giving you 15%. I'm like, God
damn. He goes, I'll do 16 because you got to deal with me. I was like, damn.
Yeah.
This motherfucker, he just throws fake rollies at people and shit.
That weren't even his.
Take his watch.
That weren't even his. Those were Damani's.
Right. Exactly.
He tries to get him back and he's like, what happened to my watches, man?
Yeah.
Like you said, he's a very despicable character. And
part of me was
kind of rooting for him just because it's like, he's just digging holes and then he's taking that hole and digging it even deeper just to, I don't know, just to try to get himself out. You know, it doesn't work that way.
Dude, that whole breakdown, then when he pours the fucking...
That whole scene I love.
Yeah.
That might be my second
tank.
That might be my second.
He's like, "Oh, you don't want to listen to me? I'll get you to listen, bitch." Yeah. Like
that might be my second favorite scene just because like you hear him on the phone and the way it like zooms in on the phone and it's like blink blink blink.
Yeah.
Blink blink blink. bloop, like for him switching between calls and shit.
Yeah.
And like he just, it's just so fucking chaotic. And you have it. You have this guy fucking bitching at him, and then he decides, you know what? Fuck this guy.
Pours right.
There's really no like peaceful moment in that movie.
No.
At all.
There really isn't.
Yeah, there is. Right at the beginning when he gets there. Does he want to go lay down? And after he gets bitched at.
Yeah.
Which I love, man. I love movies like that 5 seconds. Go, look, this is what this movie is. We're not going to add levity just because, you know, we want to get a general audience in here.
Yeah.
Like this is what we want it to be.
And I like that it didn't quite have a happy ending.
No,
you know what I mean.
I love it didn't have a happy ending.
Exactly. Yeah, it wasn't just like it doesn't just resolve and that's.
I mean,
it, you know.
I ain't gonna lie. I was happy for his side piece. Like, good for you.
Oh, girl. Yeah, she's paid off.
Because you fucking went through some shit for
him.
Which,
by the way, I don't think any of us mentioned his side piece is his coworker or employee, rather.
Yeah,
his subordinate.
Yeah. Yeah,
she's fine as shit too.
Yeah, she is.
Bro, like, man. and that's
she's
ride
or die too.
She wasn't even an actor. She was like a model or some shit.
Yeah.
No.
It's her first movie. I didn't know that. Dude, she could be a star. Like, what the fuck?
She killed it.
For,
she killed
movie,
it, honestly. Yeah. Like, I was real believable. Oh. like, I honestly, I mean, for her being, like, I was like, yeah, I didn't even know that was her first film. Like,
I didn't know that until just now.
Howard!
Yeah.
Dude, you know what I loved? You know what I loved? Is like,
the so walk she,
when she was
after
in
the fight?
Yeah, but when she was in the bathroom with The Weeknd, and she goes, how did you even get this hard?
Yeah.
And then later in the movie when he's, like, crying to her.
Yeah.
And she goes, it's just so hard. I was like, that's a great callback.
Right. And then she got his name tattooed on her ass.
Yeah.
It says Howie.
He's like, why did you do that?
Like, what is wrong with you?
Which is the appropriate reaction for a tattoo like that.
Right?
Yeah.
Hey, that's his like one that's his one moment where he actually did the right thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's like, that's stupid.
What the fuck? Damn you. I feel like shit. You're making it worse. This is not good. What was your scene, Chuck?
I'm with both of you guys. The ending.
Yeah.
The ending made the entire movie just because it's tense from the moment he hands the cash off to her and you're just wondering, like, how is this going to play out? And it ends up going the way he wanted it to, but he gets fucked anyway. Yeah.
And shout out to
like
her
every
for being
time
on
the
point,
whole movie.
Too, though.
Yeah.
He was fucking with a psychopath
like,
too much.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Honestly, like, shout out to her for being on point. She was just like, yo, that dude, he's sketch. The fuck? I'm out. I'm going to play this fucking dude who's been creeping on me since the fucking...
You mean Trump?
Basically.
Yeah.
That dude. I feel like he was supposed to be like somebody like a hardcore like good cameo or some shit, but I couldn't...
Like, I think he's known... Yeah, I think he's like a big gambler. I think he's known with like the gambler rings.
Really?
Because believe it or not, you know where else I saw him at? And you guys will not fucking believe this. And the... what's his fucking face? Oh my God. Steven Soderbergh's Ocean's 11.
Okay.
You remember when Saul's walking when Saul's walking through the floor, and then there's this one guy with big white hair like his, and a tan,
that,
he's like, oh, it's Jimmy Saratoga from whatever, and then he just like walks him away. That's him.
So maybe, because that's what I was like, I noticed like films do that, like you can feel it, like.
Well, Adam Sandler's known
I'm supposed
for doing cameos
to, right,
and having other
that
big people
too.
In there.
It's like, I was like, I'm supposed to know this guy. Like, I don't know who he is, but
that's
I'm supposed to, apparently.
I'm
like,
going to look that up later out of curiosity.
Mm-hmm.
But the way she, like, used him and everything to be like, yo, I got
this.
Well,
it's either that or she would have gotten probably
like,
killed.
Shout out to her. She was mad, like, smart with that. Mm-hmm. So, and what are you giving it?
I didn't like it as much as Red did, but I do really like the movie. I'm only going to give probably, like, a 7.9.
Okay.
Just because I think it's Adam Sandler and I can't unsee Adam Sandler.
Right.
He's Adam Sandler in every movie.
Yeah.
Can't blame you.
Yeah. You feel a little bit, but I agree with you both.
The way I see it, man, if everybody has like a 7.5 or above on a movie, that's like general consensus of like, this is really good.
Or decent. So, or worth a watch.
But
present company excluded. Present company excluded.
Jover's going to ruin it.
I'm waiting for this. All right. Go ahead. Go on your hill.
This is when I piss.
Get on your hill.
It's a joke.
Fucking ladies and gentlemen, Jofer's Uncut Gems review.
Oh, boy.
I'm indebted to the Academy for not nominating Adam Sandler for enabling this time of shitty movie. All right? There's better scripts that I flush down the toilet every morning. All right? I would rather cut my nutsack on the street, on the sidewalk of Port Authority, and then drag it across the Port Authority than to watch this movie again.
That's...
I would rather be a Browns fan because at least they're more redeeming than watching this movie again.
Go Bucks.
Wow.
Yes. This movie was just there was nothing. The only redeeming part of it was when this guy got hit. He's like a hollow cockroach that I'm glad he got fucking killed. That's it, plain and simple.
He did deserve it.
He did, yeah. Like, did deserve he,
it. I mean, well,
no argument. There. I mean,
like yeah. Honestly, no like there. Because literally, you are literally like it's a lot of what you guys have been saying. He was never happy with what he had,
right?
You know, and this is just someone that's a small fish in a big pond trying to think that he could punch his way to the ocean. That's literally what it was. You look at what he did, like he's playing with other people's money. He's like, what about the guy that you remember when he was trying to pawn off? Or no, he sold the controversial Michael Jackson piece, which was the club promoters.
Right.
Right. Like, and this guy does not, he ignores everybody until it's an immediate concern. Right. That's what it is. Because you saw when Yanni got the shit slapped out of him and shit. He's like, oh, well, look what they did to my shirt. He's like, oh, well, here's another shirt. This is a Gucci or whatever.
Gucci.
He's
like, right.
He's like, and he's like, yo, listen, I'm not fucking happy with this. You know, like, so what does he do? He leaves.
Out. It's like the old cartoons of the dams busting, and he's just trying to put his finger in the broken hole, and another hole appears.
Exactly, you know. And then with Jamani or Damani, he's like, yo, like, I'm getting out of here. He's like, nah, fuck you. And then he fucking, it's until, like, he gets fucking thrown out of a fucking building almost. Yeah. And the thing is that I think being from, like, New York during that time, or not, but, like, around that time, you deal with these fucking characters all the time, and these are just people that you never want to deal with. Gosh. Like, because this is people that have dealt, like, my father dealt with, or my mom dealt with, or, like, even my friends have dealt with. So, yeah, if people like this, fuck them. They don't deserve anything.
So, hold on. So, even to...
Yeah, but it's a movie.
So, right. So, even to piggyback off that... Wouldn't that even indicate how good of a job he did if you feel this strongly about it?
Now, correct. I'm going to give you that. I will give you that that's the only, like,
he did a great job.
Really angry about this film.
He came in like, fuck
this movie.
But, like, again, that's like, this movie didn't need to be made. In my opinion. Like, in my opinion, it didn't need to be made.
You don't think movies about heroin addicts or pieces of shit need to be made? Like,
maybe when they're redeemed, but not with this guy. Like, there was nothing redeeming about it.
He got what was coming to him.
You get what's fucking coming to you.
The movie's making your point for you. Like, it's literally telling you, like, you're
kind of, your review is pretty much making the point that this is a solid
great movie.
Because it affected you.
The movie's on your side, Joffer. The movie's on your side, It came down on his side and it said, this guy gets what's coming to him.
Exactly.
I mean,
even though he won, he still got popped.
To me, like,
not like Adam Sandler in the movie?
Oh, no. He's
I mean, the character he played, you did not like him?
No.
Did you like what happened to him?
Yeah.
How is it not a great movie?
It's not. I didn't need to see it. I mean, I had to watch it because of the show, but like, it felt like math homework to me. Honestly, like, it was needless. I didn't need to see the movie. It was...
Oh, man.
It didn't need to be recognized by the Academy. None of that. Like, it's...
Wow.
It was like, you know?
That's understandable. You're talking about like it's...
Yeah, but like what... There's movies with despicable characters that are great all the time. I don't think that's what the problem is.
What did Adam Sandler do to you?
Right? Show us on this doll.
I should feel this way about Adam Sandler. He's so full on.
Like, because your whole thing is like this fucking piece of paper. Shit.
Yeah. You just draw us a little bit.
Where did he hurt you?
I mean, even, and then, so going back to it also, like, you see that, like, even Arno at the end, he gets what's coming to him. Everybody forgets that, like, the movie's about greed. All right,
yeah. Oh, yeah.
And like it's this ugly road towards greed. So I'm like, really, like, why do I need to watch this? You know?
Yeah.
But then at the end, like, even Arno, because Arno gets hit, he's like, "Don't you fucking touch me like that? Who the fuck do you think I am?" He's like, "No, fuck you too." Boom. And then they fucking take care of him too. And what's funny is that these poor fucking morons—they're gonna rob this place. They have no way of getting out either.
Yeah.
Like.
Yeah.
So it's a shit movie, dude. Like, to me, I never enjoyed it. Like, it was like, yeah, the tension's there and everything, but it's like. What for? Like, I wasn't entertained. I wasn't, like...
Was it because the Boston Celtics were winning in it so much? Is that what it was?
How did they not have a way of getting out?
They didn't, though.
They didn't.
Because who's going to buzz them out?
Yeah, remember, right. it's a two-person system.
You could... Can't you, like, keep...
Nope.
Buzz okay, one right, person
yeah.
out.
It's a two-person... Right. And yeah. So they're going to, like, have all these millions of dollars of jewels and shit, but, like, they're not going to... There's no way of letting them out. So
yeah, because I mean, think about it. If one
could get out, and the other one could be like, "I don't know what fucking happened."
No, doors have to be closed for one to be open.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
And the thing is that remember that
and you
both gotta doors
hit
were,
the button. You got to hit the button
and,
for them.
So sure, yeah, one guy can get
it's
out.
A,
but
it's a little room that's probably what like four
yeah, but
feet
you could
by,
probably use some
feet.
Tape to push the button down. No, or
that's what I'm saying. You have to have the door closed.
Yeah,
on
like
one side.
Not only
oh,
door.
So you can't even
it has
pop
to
it open.
Lock.
That's right.
It has to lock. It doesn't exactly. have to open. It
so how does somebody go home from work?
That's what I'm saying. There's got to be.
He's got the
out.
Master key.
Yeah,
and, shit.
And they just killed him.
Oh, well, it's on him, right?
I don't think right. so. I don't
so,
know.
So, I mean, that could
why
be the case,
be?
Too. Yeah. That could be the case.
We need a sequel,
right?
Just to figure that out.
Just to get them out. No. Like, what and y'all can fucking
we
watch
do,
that.
Like, a Marvel starts off, you know?
And y'all can fucking watch that.
Hey, so you obviously don't have a favorite scene besides him dying, so we'll just skip that. How low is your score?
A quarter.
A quarter?
0.25.
0.25.
I don't take that serious.
Yeah, I can't. Can't.
My
can't.
Opinion, bro.
That's a little harsh.
Come on, Jover.
That's, was, come on.
You know how many movies have despicable characters in them?
I even gave his Freddy movie like a 3.5. So.
Right?
I'm saying.
What did you give it?
2.5.
Jesus.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. A 0.25. 0.25.
Oh, so.
It didn't even get a point.
So that what was like. So fuck? So what you're telling me is the documentary I recommended got a higher score.
Which one was your documentary?
Which one was it?
It's the
one that everyone hated.
Oh fuck! It's about the dudes that like they follow this like the, that's how the yelling couple, gay couple. They're not gay though.
Oh yeah, the guy. The,
what the fuck's it called?
You don't even remember.
Shut up, little man.
Yes. Shut up, little man.
Shut up, little man.
Actually, I think that was probably better.
Yeah, the first 10 minutes was funny
cool.
though.
Yeah, exactly. Cool. Like
Joffer. Cool.
All right. Cool. So who recommended
all
this movie?
Sigh.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. No, Bo did, and then I actually sent him a bill for my Netflix subscription this month.
Which
so Bo's got so Bo recommended the worst movie ever.
No,
for in Joker. My opinion, in for my Joker. Opinion, yeah.
As a median goes, like a median score, no.
Like basically, you even liked Uncut Gems. You can't even jump on.
I
loved
train. Uncut Gems, but I'll lie and say that it sucked if I can if I can offset the average.
Like
I'll give it a 0.2.
Jesus
0.2.
Christ. All right, so we're gonna move on to the next film, which is Bad Education with Hugh Jackman. Red picked this one, so Red,
hey, Ray Romano,
lead us out, brother.
Yeah, Ray Romano, shout out to him.
So, I watched this movie because I saw Thoroughbreds, which I fucking loved. It came out probably 2 years ago. What's her name? Anna Taylor-Joy from the movie we reviewed, The Witch. She's in it, and some other up-and-coming actress. But it was like a really weird, off-kilter movie with an interesting score. And it was about this girl that like wanted to murder her stepfather, essentially. She was trying to figure out somebody to hire to do that. Really weird movie. And I'm like, I'm going to follow this director from here on out. So the
oh,
second,
okay. I was like, so how are we getting here?
So it's the same director. So Bad Education comes out, and I'm like, I'll watch this, and Hugh Jackman's in it? Fuck
right.
Yeah. Laura, or not Laura Linney.
Allison Janney.
Allison Janney, yeah.
Allison Linney?
No,
or something
no, no,
like
no.
That.
Oh, fuck me.
I think her name was
She was in I, Tonya. She's great. She played the mom in I, Tonya.
I'm pretty sure it's
Allison Janney, I think.
Yeah. Allison yeah. Janney, I think okay, they're right. on, yeah.
I see the cast. I'm like, Ray Romano's in it. I'm yeah. like, all right, I'm going to watch this.
That surprised me, by the way.
I didn't look at any, plot
Allison Janney, yeah, you're right.
She's great, man. Have you seen I, Tonya?
Yeah.
Hers
I might
mom.
Actually recommend that, dude. Maybe.
Let's do it, man. I'm down. Right. That's the kind of bitch you would like.
Tonya Harding?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yes.
By
absolutely.
The way.
No, I got another one for you, but all right.
That's we'll a keep perfect Joffer chick. Tonya Harding.
She'll fucking knock a bitch's knees out for me. What's up, Ma?
Knock your knees out.
I know. She beat up her husband or some shit like that, too.
Oh, so fuck yeah. Dude, like her dad had her working on cars and shit when she was like fucking... You know, eight. You know, but anyway, Tonya Harding's an interesting character.
Apparently. Yeah.
Anyways, so I'm like, I'll watch Bad Education. Fuck yeah! And I didn't look at anything. I didn't even read the blurb, like the HBO blurb. Which, by the way, that's why I'm going so long with this because I recommend don't watch it knowing anything about it, because when you do, like I did, every little thing that unfolds, it's really, really interesting.
I only knew that Hugh Jackman was in it. That's the only thing I knew going into it.
Yeah. And I fucking, dude, I love this movie. It's like a true crime drama. It's about the biggest
school embezzlement.
Public school embezzlement scandal ever, basically. In Long Island, correct?
Yes.
Yeah.
Which is interesting because Uncut Gems, Long Island.
I know, right? Like, yeah,
I think we should call this episode White People in New York Getting Their Comeuppance. We should call that this episode.
But wasn't he?
He's a Jew.
But wait, is
there's still white people
in part of it in New York?
That was a Chicago.
No, he went to Chicago.
It was like some suburb in Illinois, I believe.
Was it?
I thought so.
He was. Damn it.
Okay, so we could just call it white people getting their comeuppance.
Yeah, sure. Are Jews white?
Yeah.
Okay.
Technically, I guess.
Yeah.
I don't know. It depends. Some say they're not. Some say they are. I don't know.
I would strongly argue they're not. They're not European or anything. Like, what the fuck?
That's a whole other.
Yeah. Yeah. That's, I don't really want to get into it.
Whole another show.
Back to bad education.
I didn't even think that was a debate. I'm like, all right. But. Okay. Anyways. So, yeah. Biggest public school embezzlement scandal in history to the tunes of millions.
12, I think.
Yeah, it was like 11 or 12. Yeah.
Yeah, I think it was 11.
And predominantly going to the school superintendent and the assistant superintendent, Allison Janney and Hugh Jackman. I can't remember their names, to be honest.
Hugh Jackman was Frank Tarasco?
Tarasco?
Tarasso or something?
Tassone.
Tassone. Joffre knows names like better than anybody I know.
Yeah.
Like, this motherfucker remember a name. Like, you tell him, like,
shout out to the Joe, Jews aren't white.
No, but you tell him, hey, Jews aren't white. Dude, you tell him, hey, my name's Dom Arnie. He's like, I remember that. Yeah, I don't even like your movie, but I don't remember your name.
Pretty cool name you got there.
I know, you see. That,
it's a skill,
that
man.
Shit's occupied my head now. Thank you, Bo.
Joffre,
fuck you.
Joffre, it's a skill, man. Like, honestly.
Yes, but I had to waste 2 hours watching that fucking movie yesterday.
Actually, it was an hour and, like, a half. Uncut Gems was, like, an hour
it
and
did
a half.
Feel longer. I will admit that.
Thank you.
Wow. I felt like it was done before it got started. I felt like Devs was like 2 years of my life I'm never getting back.
Yes.
See?
Yes.
Shots fired one way.
Chuck and I are on the same page about fucking everything. Did we talk about Road to Perdition yet?
No, we're not even there yet. We're still... You're still starting. You're still starting Bad Education.
All right, Bad Education. I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's another eight hours of my fucking life I'm not getting back either.
Fucking dumb.
So, I love the themes of this movie. It's like sociopathic tendencies. Mm-hmm. And I think he's a perfect example of a sociopath and how... Sociopaths kind of make their way up the ladder in these kind of situations. They kind of become these politician types.
But he already had a step up from the get-go, too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. More concerned with their perception of who they are than what they really are.
Yeah.
And, I mean, you see it all the time. Like, he's always fucking got the nutmeg and the cream and shit. And
well, that was...
That was in the jail cell.
That was in the prison.
But still, he's obviously done that shit before.
That's not jail. That's prison. That's a felony.
Oh, it's huge. Yeah.
Yeah. I wonder who boofed the fucking nutmeg for him, too.
Yeah,
right?
Right.
I mean, obviously, he had no problem with it.
He liked it even more. It's like, fuck yeah, dude.
Thank you.
Anyway.
Great.
Yeah, so... What am I saying? Fucking, I love social, the movie.
Sociopaths, perception, image.
I love the movie. I love... where am I getting at? Favorite scene?
I mean, sure, if you can't think of anything else.
Favorite scene in
By all means.
That was like a Joe Biden review right there.
Right?
Well, like, to be fair, we were going...
You know where I'm going with this.
The kids would rub my legs down, the hair would come back up.
You know where I'm going with this. And God bless America.
What I'm trying to say is I love America.
Right. But yes, there was embezzlement. There was
deceit, betrayal.
Which, by the way, is a lot. Like, there's a lot going on with his vanity.
Yeah,
where he's like actually, like I said, cream. I don't know what kind of cream it was in nutmeg.
And, well,
like,
that was the
end. In the prison. But I'm saying, like,
but you got to do the comparison.
It's like him covering up his wrinkles, so to speak.
Here,
like, there's a lot of thematic shit going on.
I got you. I got you. So in the beginning of the movie, they open up with him. And prepping himself in the mirror and everything, getting ready to accept this little accolades. And then at the end, when he's locked up, and mind you, this is factual stuff that happened.
Correct.
You can look it up. He's doing the same thing. He's prepping. But he's prepping and primping in prison.
Dude, he's got fucking... He's got flashcards for, like, the personalities of his staff.
Right.
Like, you know, the faculty.
The powwow him and Chick have where he's like, she's telling him, like, these people.
Dude, that's my favorite scene probably because it's like, this is what this guy is. It's not that he gives a fuck about you. It's that he gives a fuck about getting that budget increase and getting that skywall.
To manipulate. He was good at his job.
I love the fact that, like...
Shots fired.
Like, right here, like it would be like under the fax machine. They got the fucking the leak. What?
Shots fired.
What'd she say? I finally see you guys with real beer and make sure it's bottled. Oh shit! Cheers to you, Yuri. I'll see you later tonight.
Shout out to Yuri. Cider doesn't count, but fuck you.
I'll shut you up later.
Yeah, tonight. I think this is actually.
He's stupid. But continue,
you
sir.
Stupid.
Yeah, but like I love the visual representation of what's going on with the leak, because you have like this is bound to fall to cave in.
Everything falls down. Everything falls apart.
Exactly. Yeah. And like, and not only that, but it's a literal representation of like they're taking funds from, you know, the budget. And
they're stealing from children.
Yeah,
right.
Essentially, yeah. And I love how like the school's like fluorescent lighting, and you know, whenever he goes to Vegas or wherever he's going, like it's all fucking, you know, great time, well lit. But when it is in the school, it's very fluorescent, boring. And
I love also
thematically what it does with journalism and the fact that like these kids can fucking
unfolded
figure this
it
out.
I was going to say something about like, that actually.
A kid figures out, not a kid in real life.
And
was,
even that
group.
Though, even that. To
no, no,
take
no.
That,
it was a girl. Yeah,
like in real life.
Yeah, her name was Rebecca Robaum. Or
no,
some
but that was one of the many though. If you look it up, if you read the actual article from the New Yorker. Like, it's actually, like, they got an anonymous tip, actually. Yeah.
But no, what I was going to say is, even to kind of piggyback off the sociopath point is, sociopaths tend to shoot themselves in the foot eventually at some point. And him pushing her to be like, you should dig deeper.
Yeah. He's like,
you should go
into
that.
It's only a
puff
piece if you
he
make
got
it
busted
a puff
by
piece.
Giving her, by his own advice.
Yeah. And he literally signed
fell on
being
his own
up
sword.
For
he fell on his
that's
own sword.
That's him being a good educator.
Right.
And that's what I love about this movie, too.
Yeah,
is
he's
that
a great teacher.
What I love about this movie is it's nuanced. The guy's well-intentioned. He's actually not, I mean, in my opinion, like this is what this is how sociopaths are. They think they're doing the right thing. They think it's all for the
better
good.
He literally said that because when he even begs like for them not to go public with this until what?
Until what?
Until they vote for the new budget.
Right. Oh, yeah. Like when
he
Romano,
begs him.
He's talking to him on the bleachers and
shit. He's like, look,
he's like, dude, a few more days, man.
Yeah, he's like, wait a few more days until like, and because again, he still thinks that he has the best interest of the district in mind.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that dude, it's, and that, you know what, what I love about the movie too is these sociopathic types where they like, once again, they think they're doing the right thing. They think that this is how things, it's more about their perception than it is actually about reality. I love how the movie explores that where it's like, this guy actually is well-intentioned.
Yeah.
And he does things to get himself in this position of power. He does things to get, but it's not necessarily for the good of the district, but he thinks it is.
Right.
Like a skywalk ain't going to fucking plug the fucking holes in the ceiling.
Right.
Right. Right.
Like, but in his mind, it's like property values go up.
That was what they opened
he
with.
He literally
too.
Convinced them. Yeah. When,
yeah, yeah.
when they're like, oh, we need
it's
to go
better
public
for the whole
this.
Community.
Yeah.
The community's only as good as the public schools, however they put it.
Yeah.
And it's like, you know, I'm struggling to like articulate exactly, but.
Use Kevin words.
Use Kevin's
speak. But yeah, I think it's
money good,
example.
School good, steel bad.
But he did do good. They were number four, and they were gonna. They were close to number one.
Yeah,
and it's like it's not that he didn't do a good job.
Well, even when he was like in trouble, he's like, I could still get us to number one. He's still pleading and thinking that like he's gonna.
And
do
he actually cared when he's in prison and shit, and he's walking down the hall and he sees that. It's like a weird, trippy dream moment.
Part of me feels like he actually did care about the school.
Yeah, he did.
Dude,
I don't think there's an
eye. He gave a fuck up. Dude, when he's telling that kid, accelerate. And
he's still trying to teach him how to, like, he's still trying to educate,
And, like, I felt for him in that moment. In that moment,
and
I'm like,
honestly,
fuck.
What the fuck was wrong with that mom?
Oh, she's a piece,
no,
she's representative
like,
of all those fucking
But she's like, what's wrong with you? Bitch, he's teaching your kid. Shut the fuck up and get the fuck out.
She's the reason he's where he's at.
Yeah,
like she, like her, and her mentality of fucking like my kid is this and that.
Because there definitely are parents like that.
Oh, without a doubt,
we all saw them growing up. And,
hashtag fuck them kids.
That's a joke. We do not condone that.
That is a bodega pirate comment. None other host of the FooL and Friends co-sign with these thoughts or opinions.
Just. He's kind of he represents like a politician type, who he portrays something to the public that he's really not. I'm not gonna lie, he gives Obama vibes to me. Like that's what
we're
I see when
the
I
whole
see
spectrum,
that
spectrum apparently.
Yeah. Jews aren't white.
Right. They aren't.
We got current, we got past. I don't even know
what's a fucking debate. I mean, I guess they're lighter tone than black people.
Got him.
Get the fuck on with your review, ass.
What is your favorite scene? What is your favorite scene? Go ahead.
I'm glad you didn't get hit with that, bro. I'm so sorry.
I'm not in the splash zone. I'm good.
Oh, shit.
My favorite scene, probably Alice and Janney going home and telling her family, like, this is what paid for this house and that house. And
yo.
Like, because, like, they're all like, what the fuck? And
that's,
it's like,
the one time I slightly almost felt bad for her.
What a dipshit son, like, of hers, by the way.
Oh, I know.
Yo. What a fucking moron. It had, like...
Hi, Ma. Hi, Ma!
Yes!
Smacks that bag of chips out of his hand.
Bitch, you don't need brand new tools to do a fucking construction job either. Like,
I, like, that, so that brief moment, I was just like, damn.
But, dude, Hugh Jackman, I gotta say this, by the way. Probably my favorite performance of his, even over Logan.
It's strong.
Even
it's
over
strong.
Prisoners.
Yeah.
I thought, like, dude, he fucking killed it.
Honestly, it's funny you say that, because within, like, the first, like, 10, 15 minutes of the movie, I was like, fucking Hugh Jackman, you charismatic son of a bitch.
Right?
Right,
like,
yeah.
Why?
He's perfect for the role.
Right?
Who else plays that? By the way, I always thought Hugh Jackman was gay. So, like, this movie really...
There's a big rumor in Hollywood.
Yeah, there
is
a rumor,
yeah, like,
that he is.
I feel like he picked
and that
this movie...
his wife is just a beard.
He covers it up. He has his other persona. That
you're
he,
saying this
if
is
he
his
is,
low
it
key.
Doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter. Of course it don't. But it's funny that he chose this role. That's all I'm
I mean, it makes sense. he nailed it, though.
Like,
he
because like, me going in blind and not knowing anything, and like, I see them, he's like, let's go somewhere else to drink. And they're in his hotel room all of a sudden. I'm like, this, I know where this is going.
Yeah.
And I'm like, and only that, but I've always got that vibe from Hugh Jackman.
That scene was kind of awkward, though, because it's like, you used to be one of my students.
Yeah.
Fucking, yeah.
But that's the thing. Like, a sociopath, he doesn't think like that. He thinks, like, you know, we just have a good relationship. And I'm that good of a teacher. And I'm, I don't know. Like, he'll justify it somehow.
Great teacher, terrible person.
I'm that good of a teacher. I'll make my student
terrible superintendent, for that matter.
Right.
Yeah. So
what are you giving it?
Nine 9.5 out of 10.
Okay.
All right.
I fucking loved it. It's probably my favorite movie of the year. It's top three for sure.
Did it come out this year?
Yeah, it did.
That's why I picked it. I wanted to pick. I wanted to pick something that was new, because
technically it came out in 2019.
Well, it but it
HBO
wasn't
released it. Yeah,
yeah. It wasn't released until 2020.
Yeah. Chuckles.
But, Chuck.
So thanks, Red, for letting me use your HBO account.
Oh yeah, shout out to Red. Yeah, thank you, bro.
Told me to go in blind on this one, which I did. The only thing I knew going into it is that Hugh Jackman was in it. Yeah. It surprised me a lot, actually. And I honestly didn't know it was a real story till the end. I somehow missed the
beginning.
I missed the disclaimer. Mm. But it was a really solid movie all the way through, solid acting. It starts off with Hugh Jackman being this, like, paints himself really well as this nice guy image. He's a great teacher. Like, Bose is winning this accolade. Mm. And he just seems to be really well-loved.
Yeah.
And then you see at the movie, it's like, I'm kind of thinking in the beginning, like, they're pushing them up to be this really good guy. Something's going to happen to him.
Oh, yeah.
They're pushing for a reason.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then you see his life eventually falling apart because he's embezzling from the schools. And it's just cool to see at the end, too, when the story breaks loose in the school paper, the difference between that and the opening scene. Everybody's kind of just giving him dirty looks and staring at him.
Oh, that's like, a great,
what
dude,
the
by the way,
yeah, like,
by the way, I love the way it's shot because like you see his face and then like
you see behind him
the reaction.
Everybody's turning around and looking at him.
He's like, what's this piece of shit walking into right now? Like,
as a cinematography horror, I watch that and like, that's perfect.
Yeah, that was a really good scene. It's just interesting to watch the whole thing unfold and how he's trying to cover it. And I kind of got my suspicions when he basically didn't want to fire what's-her-name's character.
Right.
It's like, why is he covering for her? The best thing he can do right now is expose her and get rid of her. And,
right.
You know.
Sociopath.
Yeah.
She says, you're the sociopath. Like, in that
You're the real sociopath.
Yeah, that's what it was.
And then he even took it a step further, that scene right after he ordered all that shit. Because he's basically, they pushed the narrative that she had an illness or something. So that's why she retired.
Yeah.
So all that shit.
You're
going to
resign quietly.
Yo, bruh. Like all that shit that showed up to her house, the balloons.
Not only that, but then the fucking move that she does with her niece.
Yeah.
He's like, oh, well, you know, I could do things. I could say some things about myself too or whatever about what's going on. He's like, Oh, really? Because I have an eye for this thing. Is that Macy's or is that Lord & Taylor?
Yeah.
And then
Lord
&
Taylor collection.
She's like, shut the fuck up.
Well, even that is he uses his power of observation and memory to be like, oh, that necklace you got there. That's
Am I a sociopath?
Have I seen that?
And the fact that he knew which collection is from goes to show that he really is.
He said the memory thing.
And, exactly. That was the other thing, too.
I don't think you studied flashcards, sir. I hope not. I hope not.
I just had a starting revelation of myself.
But dude, to me, that was like the indicator scene of like this guy, like he cares more about perception than reality.
Yeah. But
and
also,
that's
I
how
mean,
he's also got ahead. But he's also a great educator.
Yeah,
I love that. He's like in Breaking Bad. What was the lead's name?
Oh,
Walt.
Walt. Yeah,
dude, he's like Walt in Breaking Bad, where he's like, he was doing it for his family, but you kind of get it. This guy's doing it for the kids, but you kind of get it. And then, like, but he's also fucked up.
But there is also a slight difference there because Walt was
genuinely.
No. He genuinely was, like, doing it. But then after a while, he even said, he's like, nah, fuck this. I'm doing it for me. At a certain point.
He says, he's like, we're not in the meth business. We're in the empire business.
Once he became
But I think he made that decision when he threw her under the bus.
Yeah.
When he's like, you got to resign. And then she called him and he literally just hung up on her.
Yeah.
He's like, fuck this bitch. And like they just had like that conversation on the bench where he's like, I could really go for a carb right now. And like they're really close. You
that
tell
opening
the,
scene.
You can
yeah,
tell
yeah.
they're close, and he just fucking throws her under the bus and don't give a fuck.
Yeah.
That's when I'm like, he does the Walt Breaking Bad shit where it's like he's like, I'm just gonna look out for myself. Yeah. We're gonna claim your $250,000 and hopefully they don't catch on to what else is going on. I'm gonna tell the auditor, hey, they're not gonna really audit you. Just kind of figure out what she's done and let's sleep this under the rug. She's got an illness. Let's fucking, you know, he's like trying to get himself out of it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And like, that's Walton Breaking Bad, in my opinion.
Yeah. I know. Like Chuck was saying, like,
that's why I got that vibe.
He, the way he used his sociopath, his disease, I guess you could say, in a sense, was, you know, against other people as well. Like, he obviously does pay attention because. That necklace he pointed out immediately, like, I've never seen you wear that before.
Yeah.
Like, so he obviously has that built in, but then ended up turning it into, you
and
know.
Didn't she say she bought that for her?
No. She was going to buy that for her aunt, but then after the aunt got fired, then.
Then she's sporting it.
She was like, you know what? I'm like, damn, I do like this color. But, Chuck,
one thing I did want to mention, though, that we haven't mentioned yet is how he, tells everybody that his wife died many years ago.
Yep.
Right.
But in reality, he has a husband. Well, I guess they're not really married. Are they married? Because
they weren't married.
They weren't married.
They couldn't get married back then.
Domestic
yeah, they couldn't
true,
get married
right.
back
yeah.
then.
So it's a domestic partner. In a sense, we'll just call him his husband to make it simple.
Mm-hmm.
But he has a husband for 33 years they've been together, and they never mention that. He never mentions that.
He can't go to the book club and show off. He's got to...
Right, because even when the moms comes on to him, he just kind of plays it off like,
that's
when
I knew
no
he was gay,
deal.
By the way.
Yeah.
Because the way she throws herself at him, and he goes, huh! He like throws himself back. I'm like,
pussy.
There we go. Like that ring is a story. You just knew it. Like
I ain't gonna lie.
It's not even that he turned her down. It's the way he did it.
Yeah.
Honestly,
he was like
he was scared of it.
I didn't even pick that up, to be honest with you. I bought.
And I didn't know
I still
shit about
the
movie.
The you know the wife. Like
I told Yuri. She watched
it
with me.
Kind of
I told her
suspicion.
I was like, he's gay. Like he's gay. She was like, what? Like
shout out to Big Red's Gaydar.
It was strong, but I feel that way about Hugh Jackman. You know what I'm saying?
So,
period.
Chuck,
so.
What was your scene?
That's a tough call. Probably when he's telling the mom off, because you do see him, the mom, and the kid in an earlier scene, and he's going into the like the conference room, like, oh shit, I'm just gonna deal with this, get it over with. And she's a typical like obnoxious mother, but
entitled
she
does, and
she
shit.
Does want the best for her kid. I understand that, but the kid's kind of dumb.
Fuck them kids.
He's crippled.
He was not.
He was not. He was just kind of dumb.
Yeah.
He's so mentally handicapped.
You see her. I'm not touching that comment. I'm not
Let
going
him.
There.
Let him do his thing.
And so they see him later on, and he's stumbling over the word accelerated or acceleration.
Yeah.
And you can kind of see him break Hugh Jackman's character Frank kind of breaking down a little bit, like just say the fucking word,
yeah,
yeah,
you know. And he says accelerated, 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 and he goes through this like way of how to describe it and how you know you can tell the mom wrote it for him and basically explain it to the kid that the kid would make sense. And you see that teacher moment, and then he tells the mom off. He's like, no. You're the piece of shit here.
Yeah,
no. And I like that a lot. Because
that like shows the teacher in him because he could have told her like, "Hey, kid, shut the fuck up," or "Hey, get the fuck out." but he takes it as a teaching moment, and he teaches the kid how to say accelerate.
And he did say accelerate. Catches, the kid said accelerate.
Yeah, yeah. And then after that, he kicks the bitch out. So, like...
So that's why I love that scene.
You see that shred of teacher left in him. Right. And I like that a lot. That was probably my favorite scene, because you still see that little bit of goodness in
him. But it shows, like, anybody that chooses that administrative role over, like, actually making a difference, there might be something off.
Well, that... And that's... By the way...
But he actually is a good teacher. Like at
he
heart.
Is a good teacher,
And that prior to that scene was when he was walking down, and you see all the people like they see the story had a broke. So no, you're basically
my favorite scene's that scene up to that.
Yeah,
just because when you see them walking down the hall and everybody's turning to look at him, it's so good.
Yeah,
because
you can tell he's like he knows shit has hit the fan.
Oh yeah,
and then the last thing he wants to be dealing with is fucking Karen.
Because in the beginning he's walking through saying good morning to everybody.
Yeah, facts. Straight up,
that
facts.
That is a straight up Karen.
Yep.
Right there.
Oh yeah. He's saying good morning to everybody. Everybody's saying hi until the end when everybody's saying good morning and everybody's just staring at him blankly.
And right before that, she talks to her insider trader dad.
Yes.
That was a good scene,
which
too.
Which is perfect.
He's a good dad, by the way.
Because he tells... Yeah, he is. He's like...
He's like, why did you go to jail? He's like, because I didn't say anything.
He's like, I knew that they were doing it, but I didn't partake. He's like...
Which is still wrong.
I wish I would have spoke up. And then that's when she's like, I'm going to fucking
do
this.
But the fact that he took his time and helped her do all the research and everything goes to show that he was a great dad. I respect that,
man,
too.
Facts.
I like that. That was a good one, too.
But that's how it is, too. Human nature is, like, I don't want to say it's naturally corrupting, but, like, if you have friends, like the way he put it to her, he's like, I used to, like, you know, they would come over and their kids would play in our yard. I think it's how he put it, or something like that. Like, we would have barbecues.
Right, he didn't want to
bring... He said they were good people. They were.
Yeah, and he's like, I didn't want to... He's like, I knew what they were doing was wrong, but I don't want to fucking rat on them or anything.
Right.
It's like...
Well, because he kind of gave her the same speech that Hugh Jackman did, in a sense.
Yep.
Just from different views. Because they both had that, like... I don't want you to, if you do this,
strive for higher.
This is going to, well, not even that, but it's going to affect not just this person here. It's going to cascade into other people's lives. Mm-hmm. And that's what her dad pretty much solidified. Because if I'm not mistaken, her conversation with her father was shortly after she had the conversation with Hugh Jackman.
Yeah, yeah. And he's like, hey, look, this is going to affect
a lot
of people.
He was like, now you can do this. He was just like, and he was almost kind of like, I understand.
But he kind of came off too threatening.
Right. Mm-hmm. He gave her both.
That was his big problem.
Right. And, her father pretty much solidified the same fact. Like, yeah, this is going to trickle down, but I need to do this. And it kind of full circled everything with that conversation too. That shit was like, I was sitting there like, damn, this is well written.
Can we go back to Chuck scoring?
Hell yeah.
Solid movie. Solid acting all around. Ray Romano, I had no idea he was in it, but he's good. Small role.
I hope you
really
find
peace. Great supporting role.
He gets some of the best.
That fucking scene.
He gets some of the best supporting roles. I'm just saying.
Yep. That was fantastic.
The Irishman. Fucking, what was the, oh my God, there was another big movie that I loved. Sorry, go ahead, I'm sorry.
Oh, he was the mammoth.
Bigger doesn't get that one yet.
I don't.
Ice Age.
Oh.
But he was the star. He was the star. He wasn't supporting role.
No, John Leguizamo was the star of that. True. Sid.
Hugh Jackman was awesome. Yep. I think he's a good actor all around. Period.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to give that 8.4.
Right on.
Solid movie.
All right, Joffer.
Love it.
All right. So, thank God that I watched that after fucking that other shit show. But this movie was really good. I liked... There's a lot of factors here to play, all right? Mm-hmm. You have to consider, this guy was great for the community and all this other shit. He had his flaws. He had his sociopath issues or whatever. But you have to wonder. You have to really ask yourself... Was $12 million or how much he ever embezzled, was it really too much for the community if they wanted to be number one? Because one of the things that gets me is right when Ray Romano tells him, I hope you find peace, he's like, look, you're all making your fucking millions here, and I brought you guys up.
Yep.
Like, where am I, like, what is it really that bad? Because the thing is that he wasn't stealing from Queens or he wasn't stealing from impoverished towns. He was stealing from this rich town.
Yeah.
And then that's when everybody lost their shit. Oh, well, you know, it's our money. He's stealing from our money, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, but, like, he got you guys up to number four, so...
Right. Which means other colleges were looking at
exactly,
him.
Exactly. Like, is this the price? I mean, could this be the price of doing business? You know, of, like, making a deal with the devil? You know, that's one of the things that you have to wonder when, you watch this movie. For sure, my favorite scene has to be when the girl has a conversation with her dad.
Yeah.
You know,
that's a great scene.
Because, like, she knows that she has to do this. Like, she has to pull the trigger, you know. It's not that it's a sense of justice or anything like that. It's just that, like, she figures out, like, I'm sitting on something big here. And
no 15, 16-year-old should be in the conundrum like that.
Exactly. Right. You know, like, and the thing is that, like, I guess it wasn't a threat, but it was more of like, look, this is going to tear everything apart. Everything that we've all, that this community has worked for is going to be tear asunder. Right. Do you really want to pull the trigger on this? And she's like, well, that's the way it's got to be, you know? Still, I think that it also speaks about greed. I guess that was the other thing. Like, dumb dipshit here is the one that starts everything off, you know, with, like, buying $30,000 worth of tools. $30,000, dude, and I know how to spend $30,000 worth of tools.
Yeah.
But, like, this fucking moron, and there's no sense of subtlety either. Like, because that's the whole thing. The reason that this went for so long is because these guys were able to do it with subtlety. Mm-hmm. And the thing is that as long as, and I forgot, I think it was also in that same dialogue between Ray Romano and everything, is like, everybody's like, oh, well, you know, we were doing good, so no one ever bothered to look at it.
Right.
Exactly. You know, and again, that goes back to what I'm, you know, the $12 million question. Mm-hmm. Was it really worth having him on there? Like, because was it worth to you, like, to have this great school district or not?
Yeah.
You know, because now, like, and what he said, he explained, he's like, once they start investigating that, then, you know, colleges start looking at that too. Mm-hmm. They start, you know, no's turned into yes, everything drops, and then everything else attached drops. Everything else attached to the school district drops.
Yeah, exactly.
And then I guess that also speaks to a bigger volume about, like, how the injustice of, like, school systems are always graded by zip codes and shit. You know, at a bigger spectrum because,
That, and it affects the community, too.
Precisely. You know, like, you know, a shitty school district, well, yeah, I mean, fucking, what is it, fucking 60% of us are graduated from Layton and shit, and look at us.
Yeah, pretty much. You know?
We were robbed of an education.
We're all Hillsborough County.
I think I got edumacated well.
We all graduated from Hillsborough County schools?
Yeah, you graduated from King, right? No?
We educated ourselves.
Out in Ohio, that's where I went.
Okay, so 80% of us graduated from Hillsborough County School. So
yeah.
Yikes.
Yeah, we're dumbasses.
But, you know, and it speaks to a bigger role on that, you know. Thank God that Big Rick recommended this, and I watched this after Uncut Gems. Definitely an 8.5 for me. All right.
So, for me...
It kind of unfolds like an Ocean movie, too, right? You like Ocean?
Mm-hmm.
It's like a little bit of...
Monica.
How do I put it? It reminded me of Ocean's a little bit.
Well, the thing is because it's the subtleties. Because the thing is that, like, you know, it's like he said, go look at it from a bigger than a puff piece and everything.
Yeah.
And, like...
He was his own demise in a lot of ways. Because he was too cocky.
Yeah.
He was too fucking, like, into himself. He's like... But he was a great educator, too. He was telling her, he's like,
well, and again, that's what I was actually telling them earlier. Like, was $12 million worth it to keep this guy, you know, employed?
No.
And making, you know, going, like, dude, you have some of those parents, because I really think so. When the lady
these homes and
listen, when that lady took a dog shit on Ray Romano's house, I genuinely think that was against him and not against. The superintendent. She's like, you ruined everything that we had here.
Oh yeah,
and that's the whole thing. So obviously, you don't think that $12 million was, but she thought it was,
right?
You know.
Yeah.
Then that's again because I'm repeating myself, but it's
I also think it's like a critique against, like, not to get too political, but like it is like that's the difference between public funds and private funds.
Yeah.
Like when you get taxpayer dollars, people think of it as free. That's how it is.
Mm-hmm. And the thing is...
People think of it as like, I'm going to get this budget increase anyway. But actually, it helps. Dude, like Kevin, like he's an Army Ranger.
Yeah.
He'll get like fucking batteries, free computers, computer desks, because they're trying to get rid of this shit because they want to get a budget increase because they want to have other... They don't want to order new
Bro,
shit.
I knew how budgets work when I was like in ninth grade because I was
but
about
I'm saying
it.
Like, but I'm saying like, that's not... If it was privatized, that's not how... The incentives don't work that way.
But the thing is,
it's actually like people try to be frugal and they actually try to more bang for your buck.
What I was explaining to them is like he wasn't stealing like from, you know, taxpayers in Syracuse. He was stealing from that own community.
Yeah.
Right.
And the thing is that, like, again,
it's
back to
Nassau County.
It's still stealing. Yes, you're right. But the thing is
their property increase, our properties right. values did increase.
Everybody was getting fat. Why couldn't he?
Right.
You know, that's what it was.
By the way, he was still making, I think it was $200,000 a year.
Yeah. But, so bro, in that area in Long Island, no.
Yeah, but those how far, but how far do you go, though? It's like, you know, I don't know. Like,
those little shakes he's drinking look fucking disgusting. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
you know,
coal shake or whatever. Oh,
it's so like let, pure me, black. Let me, because we're fucking way out the time frame here. So we still got.
Yeah, but we started a half hour
right,
late.
Exactly.
To be fair.
So I'm trying to, you know, balance here. It was an eye opener because it is based off a true story. Mm-hmm.
And by the way, because of the difference between government funds and private funds, he still gets a pension.
Yeah.
Right.
Which is that was true. Yeah.
He
God
would never get that. Like
the I fact was going to bring that
the
up.
The fact that they just look it over.
I hate
like,
you.
Oh,
God damn it.
Oh, it happens. Like, dude, if like, what the fuck?
It's turning into Red and Friends.
God damn it, Red.
The show's turning to Red and Friends.
Right?
Oh, I'm sorry, man.
I wanted to bring that up. You stole my point, you son
you
of a bitch.
You stole his surprise, Big Red.
I'm sorry.
Just fucking with you.
I wanted
to bring it up.
I'm sorry, man.
It's true. This shit, the system is so fucked. And that's what I loved about the end of it, where they scrolled, like, that's my favorite thing about Based on True Films, is usually at the end credits, they'll give you a little update like this is what happened or this is how it really went down or whatever the case may be. In this case, like you were saying, they basically pinpointed what the fucked up situation is with how the system is the man still gets money after the fact, after pulling
something
the bullshit.
Something like $174,000 or something?
Yeah, his pension was nothing to like turn your nose at. His pension was solid.
How about those stimulus checks that went out?
Yeah.
Yeah. Can we
$1.4 billion went to dead people.
Yeah. So that's the fucked up system.
That's a slip on politics I don't really want to get into.
I'm just saying, like, this is the problem with, like, anyway, go ahead.
But yeah, so the movie focuses.
People don't give a fuck. I think it's free.
It really does bring light to that. Mm-hmm. And it's funny because it does it in an almost a lighthearted way to an extent. Like, throughout the bulk of the movie, a lot of it is kind of tongue in cheek. There's some comedy to it.
I think it was almost like a dark comedy.
It's actually a lot of funny moments.
Yeah. And it balances well to the point where I want to say halfway through is when they finally kind of go full drama.
Yep.
And that's when things start kicking in.
But it wasn't overdramatic.
Exactly. There was no point where I was like, oh, God damn it. Like, this is fucking too much.
Yeah.
Like, it flowed. It had a solid flow to it. And his last hurrah, like, to me, that was one of my favorite scenes because it just kind of showed you he realized that was it. So he was like, the last thing I want to do.
He basically quit his job, resigned, and flew out to Vegas to be with his side piece.
Yeah.
That was a great moment, by the way, when they went out into that club.
And he danced.
I love Hugh Jackman acting like he can't dance.
Right.
Like, bro. He can dance like a motherfucker.
He's probably right at home in that club.
Bruh. He goes over there and he goes,
yeah.
I'm like, dude, I can do this.
And then the way he, like, that whole moment, like, from when he basically leaves the school, he goes out there, he even, like, has his last date with, I think his name was Kyle, I think it was.
Yeah.
And, like, he wanted to just have that moment. And even left it to the point where he was pretty much begging with him, like, don't, like, worry about what I was just.
Dude, I love the speech he gave him right before he got arrested.
Yeah, exactly. There's $30,000 in the bag. You can stretch out over a year if you're careful.
Yeah.
He was like, you're worth so much more, man. Fucking. Yeah. I can't remember exactly
what
he said.
I'm not good for you.
Yeah. And the thing is, he was still teaching at that last fucking moment.
If he had stuck to teaching, he would have been a great teacher.
That his true heart of being a teacher and wanting people to succeed also went to the last minute where he was telling Kyle.
And
like,
I love that
bro.
Aspect of him. Yeah. That's what I like that character because he's a great teacher but a terrible person.
But it shows absolute power corrupts absolutely.
Yeah.
And like he is the perfect example of like he wanted more.
Well, not even that. The way he explained it too is when he explained it to Ray Romano how he was like, it started off with the bagel.
Yeah.
It started off with the meal.
No, it started off with the meal.
The Greek salad.
The Greek salad.
Yeah. He only used the wrong card.
$20.
No one noticed.
I'll pay it back on Monday. On Tuesday, I was buying a 60-cent bagel.
And nobody gave a fuck.
Yeah, and he's like,
and then it was a bagel.
And again, that goes back to my point. If everybody was getting fat, why not him?
And you know what? Before I watched this movie, like literally the same day, I was walking down the street, and this girl, this woman like standing out in her yard doing yard work. She looks over at the light, and it's like, this is noon, right? Middle of the day, there's a light, a street light that's on.
Yeah.
And she looks over and she's like, eh, it's just our tax dollars. And I was like, that's fucking on point, actually.
Yeah.
Like, and that's how people think of this shit. And then I watch this movie later and I'm like, dude, that's a perfect example of this.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, I
where
mean,
people just don't, they don't think about it because it's like, it just gets taken out of your check.
Well, that
whatever.
And
you
it
think
also
it goes for the better good.
It also showed a little bit of the idea.
And if
of
people
the,
think this is like not something that happens all the time,
yeah, no,
like,
it does.
They were just extravagant. Like they got too crazy. You know what I'm saying? Kids mm-hmm. caught them.
Yeah,
exactly.
Right.
Kids caught
well,
them.
Well, and like, it's funny because again, he pushed her to do it.
And apparently, in real life, the Allison Janney character, she would drive in and like I can't remember the exact car, but it was a nice. You know, this Lambo or some shit. And it had like a license plate that literally was talking about like, fuck, I can't remember now. Honestly, like, because I watched it like about a month ago.
But why would she park
the
car in the street? Park in the fucking driveway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That bugged me.
But it was like, they were so in your face.
No,
about
but that's
it.
How
it
nice
like,
Long Island is of
like,
a community.
Dude, but they got like an anonymous letter. That's how they knew. And then like, you know, these kids are going after them. And it's like, and all of a sudden these big papers caught on. And they really fucking caught
the
on
the fucking FBI
moms.
Shows up.
Yeah, it's like, fuck, dude.
Yeah, that whole...
Anyway, there's a whole...
It's a really good movie, and it's an eye-opener. It's a true story.
What's your favorite scene?
His last hurrah, basically. When he leaves the school to his last moment with Kyle and him in prison, like his little kind of either dream or fantasy he has about walking back out there to number one. Like I was just like,
that was great.
God damn. Yeah. Like, is it the movies? I always kind of somewhat enjoy those movies that do that. They start at the end in a sense, whether it's circling back like they did in that or like Road to Perdition, how they start the end.
Can't
and
wait to talk about that.
You know, so just that whole ending, just like, and it shows you again, he's still him because the primping in prison with the nutmeg and the lotion and shit. Like he was still trying to be him.
Yeah,
you know?
Right.
So yeah, it was crazy. Hugh Jackman's obviously phenomenal as always. I'm giving it a solid. We're gonna go 8 again.
Right on.
Another 8.
I feel good about my pick. All right.
Yeah, it was a good movie. Yeah.
All right, last one. Road to Perdition, 2002.
2002.
Yep.
Tom Hanks.
Paul Newman. R.I.P.
Paul Newman. Yeah, rest in peace.
Jude Law. Daniel Craig.
Daniel Craig. David Craig sings. Can you feel me in?
Craig David.
Yeah.
Can you feel me?
Yep.
Oh man, classic. Ah.
And he actually dropped
that
song
album
that
was
time.
Hard though.
Yes, it
that
was.
Album was really.
Yes,
good.
It was. I'll dap you on that one, bro.
He had some
try
good.
To say goodbye,
I'm Walking Away was good, bro. Walking Away was a dope fucking cut.
Yeah, true.
Rendezvous was a good cut too.
Yes.
But there was a lot of good people in that movie. This was Chuck.
It was my pick.
So Chuck,
lead us off, Chuckles.
So I had seen this movie in the theaters back in 2002, going in blindly, and I loved it. Watching it again, like as an adult, I love it even more. That movie stands up so well. Basically, it's about Tom Hanks, who his character Michael Sullivan, very Irish family, very Irish town, which is definitely Chicago,
Irish mob,
and he works the Irish, basically the. I guess the Irish kingpin. I guess
yeah,
in that
like,
small
yeah.
town
yeah.
area
during a
because this is 1931.
Depression.
This is
31,
this is during depression times
and
too.
He basically does what the will of his boss. So they want him to go take somebody out. He does. He has two sons and a wife, and his eldest son actually ends up sneaking in the car on a trip, and witnesses basically one of their guys being murdered for being a rat, basically,
yeah,
and selling. I think it was like liquor under to people that he should have been selling it to.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
So he basically becomes a wanted man because his son saw too much.
Mm.
And Daniel Craig's character, who is the son of Paul Newman, who is the kingpin, ends up killing his young son and his wife. At that point, Michael Sullivan or Tom Hanks kind of loses his shit and decides that he's wants revenge.
Yep.
So he basically the movie is a play on words, which I love. Because Road to Perdition, the Perdition is a town in, I think it was Massachusetts or Connecticut, one of the two?
Yes.
Something like that, yeah.
And he ends up following through, taking the Road to Perdition, the Road to Damnation, taking his pittance.
Technically speaking, everybody is kind of through that area.
There's a lot of Catholicism.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely, yeah.
Like, it's like really...
Like, all of our films are in
which
the
is Northeast. The 1930s,
right?
Especially Irish.
That's why I said Northeasterners.
Orthodox.
Dude, but it's like awesome. I think
the title is perfect because he's given the option when he goes to Chicago to see, I guess it's an affiliate of a
Well, Mr. Nitty.
Stanley Tucci's character.
Yeah, Mr. Nitty. I'm pretty sure he was
Tucci's like
he's so good
he's
too.
Like Capone's like underling. Like he's right yeah, there right. under Capone, basically.
He's more of like the bookman, I guess.
Yeah, I would say he's probably like one of Capone's like
accountants.
Top guys.
Accountants, yeah, that's a good word for it.
I thought it was accountant. Yeah.
So he goes to him.
Well, the accountant was the guy.
Yeah, that's a different guy. I'm sorry.
Who
yeah.
was his name? The dude, in the hotel. The guy.
Yeah, he's the guy that was doing the fucking.
He
Wall
sets
Street.
Him up for Jude to.
He had the Wall
come
Street
up.
Fucking deal name. Going.
You know exactly what I'm talking because he's in so
it,
much
too.
Shit.
It looks
too.
Like a money machine, but it's like a Wall Street like
yeah
connection. Yeah.
Oh yeah, yeah. The,
you know what I'm talking about? It was like really code. Loud and you couldn't hear. Yeah.
What a ticker tape?
Yeah.
Ticker tape. Yes.
Yes.
I'm old.
So he goes to.
No, you just know the terminology. I didn't know.
I'm going to just call him an affiliate because they're all connected.
Yeah.
And he says, I want to work for you.
Mm.
And he basically says, I know what happened. If you want to kill Daniel Craig's character, whose name I can't remember right now.
Connor.
If you want to kill Connor, I can't hire you. I want you to work for me, but not under these circumstances.
Mm.
It's like, if you open this door, there will be no more protection. You do understand that, right? So he, in return, chooses the road to perdition.
Right.
And damns himself by killing Connor anyway. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
And the whole time.
Great fucking scene, by the way.
Oh, absolutely.
Fuck.
Love it.
Mm.
Dude, the way it follows him down the hall and then it goes up over his head and comes back
yes.
around. Dude, the shot.
Again, single take, that's why.
As a cinematography whore.
Single
movie,
take.
It's so like, so Hanks comes down the hall, takes a gun out, fucking makes sure it's ready to go. It comes back around. It follows him down the hall. The guy leads him in. He goes to the fucking bathroom. You don't know who's in there. And he
in
goes,
the bathroom?
Yeah, he's in the bathtub.
I kind of, we kind of all knew.
Huh?
What?
That was Connor in
so,
the bathroom.
So, I didn't know.
Oh.
Well, I mean, you know, but you don't see him.
But at this point, he's like, taken out several people, too. Yeah. So.
Right, that's because what I'm saying. Yeah. At this point, he's big leader.
Okay, you know, but you don't officially, you don't see him.
I guess.
Right.
But sure. So, he shoots him, and then he fucking knocks the door, and then you see the mirror, and you
yeah.
see
no,
his
no, the way
it's out.
Shot, beautiful, but like, I can't okay. agree that you didn't know it was going to be
okay,
him.
You knew it was him, but you didn't know.
But yes, the way it happened,
when you know, you know. You see him, his fucking brain's blown out on the fucking wall.
I'm just saying, I agree with you the way it's shot.
Yeah.
But not knowing it was going to be him, nah, you lying.
No, you're right.
You lying.
No, you're right. I should say.
Like, no. Bro, this is like
okay,
the last
Bo,
10 minutes
Bo.
Of the movie.
Bo, you're right. You're right, but I'm saying you get the confirmation.
Yeah,
through,
yeah, yeah,
you get the confirmation
yeah.
through the mirror.
It was a beautiful scene.
Yeah, yeah. With
beautiful.
That one shot, I'm
yes.
saying.
Okay. Oh, gorgeous.
I worded it wrong. I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, you're good.
So but still, it was a great shot.
Blood
he
on the wall.
He ends up killing yeah. Connor. And kind of goes on the run, basically. In which return, they send Jude Law's character after him to kill him.
Fuck,
he's basically
Jude Law,
kind
man.
Of a hitman that also gets his job by filming dead people, taking pictures of dead people at crime
also
scenes.
Sociopath.
So
also a sociopath. He's a weird character.
We had a
movie.
Solid lineup of sociopaths from the Northeast.
Right? I guess yes. that's our theme this month?
Yeah. This or literally, this these doesn't three that, movies, we unintentionally picked sociopaths from the Northeast.
That's true.
That's true. Weird.
Huh. How about that?
All right.
All the scores are great.
Yeah.
Every movie.
So basically, he goes on the run.
We don't count.
And,
Uncut Gems had a great score. Objectively, go ahead. I'm sorry.
I'm gonna let you finish. There's always this one of those. So he ends up robbing banks to make some money on the side. And there's even one scene where he robs a bank and he says, I want Al Capone's money.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I was like, holy shit, you have some balls if you're going after Capone's yeah. money.
Well, I mean, he's already dead anyway, so.
Yeah, exactly. And, he ends up going on the run. Eventually, Jude Law does catch up to him at his sister-in-law's place up in yeah. Perdition. And that scene was amazing, the way it's shot, too.
I fucking hate that much, because I remembered it, right? And I was like, where the fuck does Jude Law come from? I know he comes from somewhere. And I forgot that he's just sitting right
literally
the fuck
think,
there.
You literally think they're in heaven.
Everything
I think
white
that was
and pristine.
A call out too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, it's so it's yeah. nice because the room's the, painted white.
The cinematography when the blood splatters and everything,
yes.
dude. Like,
oh.
Yes, exactly. There's so much symbolism, but that's Sam Mendes yeah. in general. Even in the
yeah.
beginning, when they find his wife and his youngest son killed, he basically says, "This is not your home anymore. This is just an empty house."
Yes,
yeah.
They leave. Mm-hmm. The car leaves, and there's a bike in the snow, basically symbolizing mm-hmm. his son's. Childhood being left behind.
Correct.
Yeah. And that symbolism is just fantastic
yep.
the way he does it.
Oh, yeah.
Sam Mendes is a great director. He's kind of a creep in real life, but he's a great director.
He's a creep?
Oh, yeah. He had directed American Beauty with Kevin Spacey. He's got some weird times.
Thor, yeah. But even so, that he movie was visually stunning.
It was a fantastic movie, but he's a creepy man.
He was 33 when he made that. He was not young, but for a director.
Either way, though, I mean, like creepy as it was a solid film.
But
like,
he also did Jarhead and two of the.
No, we're not.
He also did two of the Bond movies with Daniel Craig, so he did work with Craig. Well,
we're not going to go that deep in.
Going on three or four now.
Oh, really? But I know he did Spectre and Skyfall.
He did,
and then he did
Road to Perdition was his second movie. American Beauty was his first,
which was 99 to 2000.
Spectre. Yeah, this came out in 2003, something like that, and. 1917, by the way. Fucking.
Oh, yeah, he did that. Or did he produce? Or did
no,
he
made it.
He directed it.
Okay, yeah.
He's incredible, dude. Dude, Sam Mendes, I don't know why, he is super under fucking rated. Underrated.
He doesn't do
like,
a lot.
Nobody talks about like Sam Mendes as a director. They talk about his movies. Road to Perdition, by the way, is one of the most
underrated nobody knows movies. About it, and it's
sad. Underrated movies ever. Like, one of the most underrated movies ever.
Facts.
And Paul Newman. The cinematographer.
R.I.P. to the god.
The cinematographer. Yeah, awesome. One of the reasons, like, I looked it up because I love the cinematography so much. The cinematographer did Cool Hand Luke with Paul Newman.
Wow.
And Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid.
Wow, no kidding. All
right.
So, like, and apparently, like, I saw some trivia on this, and, like, I don't know what shot it was exactly, but there was a specific shot where the cinematographer, both are dead, by the way, now, the cinematographer and Paul Newman.
Mm.
But this was the last movie they made together.
Oh, wow.
And, dude, he shot a scene with Paul Newman, and he started crying, and they were like, dude, what's
wrong? Oh, I know exactly what scene that was. I know exactly. It had
probably the end scene.
It had to be the shootout.
Yeah.
Because, dude, the way everybody went around him down.
So good,
but he started crying, he's just like, and they asked him, they're like, are you good? And he goes, he's just so beautiful.
Yeah.
Paul Newman's a legend.
Which gets me.
That scene.
That got me so much.
Yeah.
Like, he said he's beautiful, like Paul Newman. And it's like, dude, like, this is their magnum opus. Well, I wouldn't say it's magnum opus, but it's like, it's their.
It's one
their
of
their swan song.
No, it's their magnum opus.
It's their swan song. Yeah.
So, we're going to.
This was their swan song.
Let's,
swan song.
Let's
like,
fun
Chuck,
fact about Paul Newman,
oh,
by the way. This scene where he's talking to Michael Sullivan, Tom Hanks, in the church basement, I guess is a basement.
Yeah.
It's a fantastic scene. That quote, he says, this is the life we chose, the life we lead, but there is only one guarantee that none of us will get into heaven.
Mm-hmm.
There's a Canadian death metal band called Cataclysm, and they have an album called Serenity and Fire. They open up the album with that clip.
Wow.
And for the longest time, I never made the connection. I've been listening to the album since 2004 or 2003, whenever it came out. And when he said it, I was like, where do I know this from?
Right.
And then finally clicked, and it's like, holy shit, it just now made that connection, like almost two decades later.
How about that?
So what was your scene?
Ooh. Probably the period where they're robbing the banks and the son's starting to learn how to drive. That whole bit you actually see, because like, it's really uncommon in that time for fathers to be really open and loving to their kids.
Right.
It's just how it was.
Yeah.
And to see him start to become more loving and open and accepting of him, and just, it was a really good character development on his behalf.
Yeah.
And just the fact that, you know, the son's learning how to drive. He's just slowly driving up because he's learning the clutch and everything.
Yep.
Right.
He's like, oh, no hurry or anything, you know.
Right.
Little jokes like that. And then eventually he just drives off and leaves them. That whole little, like, I guess, kind of a montage, but not really.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That whole bit I love.
I mean, yeah, I mean, it's a montage. He robbed, like, what, three or four different banks in that, like, what, 5-minute period? Seven-minute period?
The whole thing takes place over 6 weeks.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
But that scene that itself was, like, what, like 5-10 minutes?
So, roughly, yeah.
So, yeah, it's a montage. You could say that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like that part a lot.
It was solid. It was solid. All right, and what's your score?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh.
You moved on.
You're good. Let me give a score.
This movie. I liked it better the second time around. Extremely underrated. By all means,
facts.
If you want a good movie
and
you haven't seen it, go watch Road to Perdition.
Yeah.
I'm going to give it a 9.5. I love that movie.
Right on.
Jover.
All right, so this movie hits a bigger button for me. Because my dad died and everything, but it also speaks to a different, deeper, I think, theme. That what it is that the bond between a father and a son is that the father always wishes the best for his son.
Facts.
All right. And even though my father says that he wanted me to do something more with my life than to be a mechanic or an electrician, I still have all his tools and everything like that. I still pick up part of that as like almost a tribute to him, or almost like as a way to memorialize him. That's why I still have his car and everything.
Mm.
Still, though, the thing is, it's a very beautiful thing, because even like remembering when he teaches his son how to drive, that's, even though me and my father, we went back and forth, that still brings up a lot of like conjuring memories of like what could have been, you know? a great movie, beautiful movie. And the one thing that always touches me is at the end, all right, when Sullivan is shot and then the son sees everything that's happening and he goes to pull the gun. And then Tom Hanks, with his last dying breath, just fucking claps fucking Jude Law, duns it. And he says, my father never wanted me to do what I wanted to do. He's like, he says, he never wanted me to raise a gun or pull a trigger. Mm. And it's like, for once, like for that one split second, you think that he's going to break that vow. But he's like, no, my son's not going to be raised as a killer. He's not. He's going to be raised
Michael
as a veteran.
I'm sorry I couldn't do it. And then Tom Hanks says, I know.
Right.
I know.
And then he's like, it's so
proud,
okay.
but dying at the same time.
Yeah, he's so proud because he knows that his son's not going to be anything like him. Right. You know? And it's always a parallel that I've always taught, I've always spoken with Big Red about too, is that a son is always one of two fathers. The father that his father was, or the father that his father never was. And that speaks into so many volumes because you could have a scumbag father and you could never be like that man.
Exactly.
You know? Or you can be a good father, or and you could be you could turn out to be a good father because your father was a good father.
Right.
In this sense, like his Sullivan knew that he was he became a good father because before this movie you saw this distance, like even when he was getting ready, like he saw like this awe and like almost like this because he
adoration,
was looking yeah like adoration, but from a distance because he doesn't even go into the bathroom when he's getting ready or anything like that. He just sees him getting ready, and then you see that like there's this bond between them both.
It's when he hugs his dad.
He takes out a rosary and then the gun. By the way,
yeah,
a lot of Catholicism.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Which I don't jive with
Irish culture anyway, but
it's awesome.
Yeah, but because... and the thing is, it's beautiful because at the end Michael says, "I couldn't do it," and he's like, "It's okay, son." Like that, I know is like saying, son, it's okay. Like you're better than this, anyways. Like, and then he goes back to his to the couple. He's like, okay, I'm gonna leave all this life behind. Like, and but he says he's like, I will never forget my father. And then as another like symbol of like everything that his father has taught him, he gets back into the car and he drives himself to the couple. And I think that's the beautiful thing about that movie, that like there's this father and son thing that like again the message is that a father always wants what's best for his son. His father can be a shit digging like guy, but like he's like, you're never gonna do this. You're gonna be better than this.
And there's a lot of, once again, Catholicism, father being like God.
True.
And there's a lot going on there as well. And I think Jude Law. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Yeah. But no, and then my again, that's my favorite scene. Like at the end, because even the prologue or the epilogue, I think. The epilogue, it's after, right?
Yeah.
The epilogue, he says, I never took a life. I never held a gun after that. Like, but I will never forget my father, you know? Right. And I think that's the beauty of it.
Because he was only like 12.
Yeah, exactly. He's like, but even then, like, even if he was going to be older and everything like that, I think his father still never wanted that life for him, you know?
Of course not.
And to that end, the score is going to be a 9.75. I'm going to give it that. Nice. Yeah, so.
All right.
9.75.
Okay. Yeah.
That's a huge difference from
right from what
like
I started.
Your 10 right there.
Yeah, right.
It's like 0.20 to 9.87.
9.87.
I'm making up scores now.
Nice. Road Perdition, saw when it came out in theaters. Watched it again for the first time.
I still remember in high school you telling us how good that fucking movie was.
I saw that shit. Wow. I think I went with somebody I was dating at the time, I think. And I was like, I think we're juniors. Yeah, we had to be. Yeah,
no, seniors.
2000 was it?
Yeah, because it came out late 2002, right. And we were already on our way out.
Yeah,
so.
I was stupid impressed by it. I was just like, yo, because I'm used to Tom Hanks.
You know why?
Funny.
I know it definitely came out in late 2000 because it was going to make an Oscar run for 2003. That's what it was.
And he already obviously Tom Hanks has range. We know this,
and he was fantastic in
and
the movie.
I think. Castaway was prior to this, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, 2 years prior.
Yeah, and
Toy
so that was
Story,
like
that
one of the last movies he did was...
Catch Me If You Can came out the same year.
Which I have yet to see that.
Really?
You haven't seen Catch Me If You Can?
I was not big fan of Leo DiNardio.
Dude, you'll love it. You'll love it.
DiNardio.
I can't wait for you to watch it now.
I didn't jump on Leonardo DiCaprio train until Departed.
You mean The Departed?
Departed. That fucking movie.
I haven't seen that movie.
But yeah, Tom Hanks...
Cranberry juice.
Honestly, Tom Hanks did a good job in this, but it was still hard for me not to see him as like the funny guy a little bit. Just because, Woody and Big, like those are stick so heavily in your head.
Dude, but no, Tom Hanks is a
but
chameleon.
He killed it. Yeah,
he's a
fucking
chameleon.
He's got some range.
Yeah, he does.
Hey, suggestion. Russell Crowe.
What about him?
Yeah, what about
would he have done a better job?
No.
Oh, was he up for the role?
I think he was.
No.
I feel really confident. We do LA Confidential. He would have been good.
Exactly.
He would have been good. It wouldn't have been the same, though.
Yeah, because
think.
Okay,
of course it
would.
Well, let's put it like this. I wouldn't trade in this Tom Hanks performance for that.
This roster.
But I do think it would probably fit better.
I would say Gary Oldman over Russell Crowe.
Yes.
Well, yeah.
I would.
Oldman? Any day of the week. Right. Yeah, Brett.
Because he's awesome in everything.
Dude,
I love Gary Oldman, don't get me wrong, but I think Russell Crowe would be fit for that.
Here's
role.
The thing.
He would have been good, but
I don't think when he guns down all those motherfuckers and shit, like,
I think
I
that's
didn't believe
the only
it
part
as much from Tom Hanks, to be honest.
Right, but I think that's the only part that he would have succeeded. I think Tom Hanks brought what to the character was, and that's exactly, that's all you're getting. With Tom Hanks, you did get that softer side that you probably wouldn't have gotten.
Like I said, I wouldn't trade
it. You got the character development.
It's what is it? It's how is it? The metal hand in a rose glove or in a silk glove? That type of deal, you know.
But
the thing is, with Russell Crowe, you're just going to get the fucking iron fist all the time,
right?
You know.
I think he plays
Russell Crowe doesn't have that much.
Just like LA Confidential, though. You, I don't know. You,
Russell Crowe.
Look what Russell Crowe
doesn't have that much. Yeah, that's one of his better roles, though.
Yeah, that was his better one of his better roles. And what was he playing, dude? He was playing a meathead, out of control cop.
Facts.
Yeah, but you felt for him, and there
you did. But then, like, even the double tap, he bitch slapped her twice,
well,
dude.
He's good in Gladiator too, though.
He did.
Right, but I mean, what he doing?
Different time jump.
That's true.
Wow, only 10 years apart, right. Literally. Like,
but
you're reaching at straws here, man. You're grasping at straws here, Big Red. You're grasping at straws.
I don't know why, man. But like when I was watching the movie, I was thinking like, because of LA Confidential.
Yeah,
I was thinking like, man, I think Russell Crowe would actually kill this.
I honestly thought it was a very well casted movie.
Yes, it was.
No, I like Tom Hanks. Don't get me wrong, but that was random. I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, you're good.
But I do think I would have loved seeing that.
I don't think I would have enjoyed it as much.
Yeah. It would have been the same.
No, but just God, I loved, like you said, the cinematography of it. That was fucking great. Like a lot of those shots, the first, I love how too the beginning, the big moment in the rain, the last big moment.
You notice a lot of people die in the rain.
Yeah, mm-hmm. But the biggest, most impactful moments in the rain. Yeah. His son seeing the first murder, and his pops basically.
Dude, that was not like a comic book, by the way.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah.
Like, the way he shot him in the head.
No, it was. Like, it's based off of a graphic novel.
This is like Sin City
look.
Is it really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Dude, it's a DC comic.
Yeah.
How about that?
No shit, I didn't know that.
That's what's funny. I was going to bring that up, actually. First thing, I'm like, nobody talks about this being a DC comic book.
I didn't know that.
I think you brought that up in the chat, didn't you, or something like that? I don't know why. Or maybe I'm having deja vu.
Nobody.
No.
When he brought it up. On the podcast last week,
that's what it was when
it's
I watched
DC
it.
DC movie, and he was like, "Really?" I'm like,
"No, because I." So like, yesterday,
nobody
after,
talks about it.
Yesterday, after I watched Uncut Gems, I went and rewatched the show, and I was like, "Who am I sending my fucking bill to this week?"
The only difference is Jude Law's character is not in the comic.
Oh, really?
Yeah, like he's completely added, and I think it's great because he symbolizes the devil. He's running.
Well, that
devil.
I mean, dude, his character in general
is basically
dope as
death
fuck.
Chasing after Michael Sullivan.
Yeah,
you know,
basically,
and then he catches up to him, but he's able to defeat the devil so that his son could, like, he basically plays like a Jesus
Once
role
again,
he's like a martyr
perdition
in a weird way.
It's exactly. about the pittance, you know,
but
it's like, it's incredible writing.
He sacrificed himself to save his
it's
son.
Incredible that they took that comic and they made it even more
right,
and I love it, man.
I will say too, Daniel Craig being pretty much a villain,
He played a real jackass.
Yeah, like he nailed it. Like I really despised him.
I loved when Forrest Gump killed James Bond. I loved it.
Yeah.
Yep.
Forrest Gump killing James Bond.
Yep. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yes.
Please.
Yes.
I was about that. I was
who saw
like,
that
yo.
Coming? Who yo. Saw that coming?
I'm not a smart man, right? But I know how to clap a motherfucker.
Fuck, bro. We were driving. Like, bruh.
Jenny, hold my side piece for me.
When he finally used his gun.
Y'all killed Jenny.
Right.
And Forrest Jr.
Life is not life.
Y'all sons of bitches finna get clapped now.
So I
little Forrest, start handing out these hammers. We're gonna start to clap hammers here now.
Yo, fucking greatness. Shit. Just everything.
Do you
want to
talk about a remake? I want the dialogue of Forrest and fucking James Bond in that fucking assassination.
Oh my god, yes.
The
Bubba,
dude.
All right, so the favorite scene for me though was him mowing down everybody. That the just one because I love it when they sometimes do that where they take out the audio and they just play the music as it goes through that type of fucking moment.
It started off with the rain,
right,
and then it slowly built into the piano.
Yes,
and then
and I like that too because of the moment they had in the beginning. Where they're sitting at the piano playing together, like
yes,
you see just the hatred in Connor's eyes, like yo,
the relationship.
But you see the relationship between Tom Hanks, yes. Paul Newman's exactly. character. It's like a father son thing that and Connor like, him did not have.
It was big part two,
right?
I said that to my wife. Right. Same thing.
Yo, I'm glad we all thought that shit because I was sitting there like
1930s Irish gangster version of Big.
But no, that the way they shot it, how everybody's dropping around basically his dad.
Yes.
Because that's pretty much his dad. They mentioned that in the movie where he never really knew his father. And the homeboy, Mr.
I can't remember his name for the life. Mr. Rooney?
Yeah, John Rooney. He basically became his dad.
Yes,
he did. He left him standing. And he didn't move either. God damn it, that's so good. Because you know from the way it was shot and just how he's standing there with his hand on the door. Like, if it was an anime, he would have dropped dead after everybody. But it was basically the symbolism, like him knowing, like, I'm not going to die. I'm going to be the last one. He's gonna say goodbye to me.
I'm glad it was you.
And it was you. I'm okay with this. Like he was accepting that, and he didn't. He wanted to kill him, but he didn't. And you could see it in his eyes, the frustration. He was like, "Fuck."
The inner turmoil.
Yeah, this is it.
There was a lot of guilt in his eyes.
Yes, mm-hmm. And again, I love how it contrasted to originally his. The first kill of the movie, in a sense.
Because it was never his intention to have the wife and the young son die. That was all Connor going
through. Exactly. Exactly. So it kind of full circled. That it was great. And the shot where you see Paul Newman, he's just kind of looking. You see the rain dripping, and he's just got that look.
The rain's beautiful.
Fuck, man.
Oh, yeah.
The whole fucking, oh, my God.
That
the whole scene.
And that one, honestly, though, and the cinematography on Jude Law's intro. Where he takes the picture of the guy with the knife, and the way you see it, like how it like
through the lens,
boom, and it kind of zooms out. Mm. Right.
It's interesting because
when he's shooting Tom Hanks like he's one of his fucking like at the end, I'm like that is so creepy. Like
because to go back to Jude Law's character, you see him filming the first guy, the image is inverted. Like the devil is inverted, you know, the whole thing. So it's like he's the devil. So it's like you got that sitting right there in front of you.
Devil.
facts, man.
But yeah, it's
he plays he symbolizes the devil.
Yes. Sure.
Yeah, he does.
Father figure and then I ran from the devil.
And he's running and he's running from him the whole time, dude. He's like literally catching up to him. Like it's fucking beautiful.
Their initial introduction to each other in the diner.
Oh, that was great.
Oh, and Tom Hanks character's sweating, you know.
Yes. Yeah. I looked for that too. I was just like, I wonder if they
one beat of sweat
where they swapped over to Jude Law and they came back. I half expected the editing to be like that droppy somewhere else, but it was perfectly in the same spot. Shout out to that. Overall, the movie is solid. Fucking 9.5.
Sam Mendes is such a great director. Yeah.
All right, Red.
I haven't talked about it.
You haven't. This is your turn.
So
for real this time.
Paul Newman, his last live action role. I think he did Cars, right?
Yeah. Great role, by the way. I'm going to fight you on that one.
This was his last live action role. The cinematographer, I'm pretty sure his last movie as well. And they worked together, like I said earlier. Mm. Cool Hand Luke and Butch Cassidy.
Again, magnum opus.
Yes. And, dude, by the way, Paul Newman kills the fucking movie.
He's a legend. Is there anything that he's done that isn't shit?
May he rest in peace, by the way.
Might be the best to ever do it. Like, in my opinion.
Dude, even in Cars, he was fucking amazing. Like,
all he did was, like, read lines, you know?
That's exactly. It, dude. He taught fucking Lightning McQueen how to drift and shit, but, like, even then, he fucking bodied that, so.
Yes.
They even kind of
voice actors don't get enough credit.
What's up?
I think his, like, character kind of looks somewhat like him.
Yes, he did. No, they designed him specifically after that.
They all did. Like, even the McQueen looked like Luke Wilson.
All the
Owen Wilson.
Most cartoons, they usually do that.
Wow.
Most of the cartoons you know they usually do.
No, Owen Wilson, wow.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
I got it.
Thank you, Chuck.
I did it first.
But voice actors don't get enough credit.
They don't.
Yeah, but Paul Newman fucking kills it. He actually got an Oscar nomination for this.
Not
he should have.
I think he actually,
should,
did he
should have received
no,
it.
He didn't win. He
should have won.
Yeah.
I can't remember now, but yeah. He got an Oscar nom. Didn't win. Should have won. Like
yes, he should.
Fucking everybody killed it. All the roles. Stanley Tucci even.
Nobody small talk- role, but he was
yeah,
awesome.
Yeah, right? Like, he fucking killed.
But he's a great actor in everything.
Yeah. Dude, also, can we respect the fact that, like, as young as Sam Mendes was when he fucking made Road to Perdition?
Yeah.
Dude, and with all this fucking talent. Like, imagine you telling Paul Newman how to act.
Yeah.
Fuck right. That, bro. Like,
he's
no.
Been doing it before you were born.
Exactly. He's like.
Working with a cinematographer from Cool Hand Luke.
Bro, like, you've got two old school.
Fucking mind.
Yeah, like. All right, tell us what
a
to do.
Think like, about how talented you got to be as a dude bro, to be like, we're going to put our faith in Sam Mendes.
Bro, no,
it's
not only that.
Like, gangster classic
dude,
movie.
And not only that, yeah. But, like, the cinematographer is asking you what to do. I was like, motherfucker, tell me what to do.
Yeah. God, man. Yeah. I love this fucking movie. What are we going to do? Scene? Yeah.
Scene and score.
So my favorite, the score. Well, scene. Talking about like the score. The
scene,
score,
then score.
I want to talk about the score because I do actually love the fucking score.
Like, he's talking about the music. I get that.
As soon as he said it again, I was like, oh, God.
No, you're right, though. The music is
bro,
very, very yeah. Good. It
yeah. Am I lying?
So well.
Yeah.
Like, no, I was you're talking right. About your actual score,
of,
not
that,
the...
I know.
I don't know the name of the piano piece they played, but it was beautiful.
That's one of those movies, though, like, you let the credits roll because, like, I want to listen to this music.
But, all right.
So, I love the score.
clearly you did.
Right.
My favorite scene has to be... It's probably when he kills off Paul Newman's character.
Yeah.
I mean, I think everybody thinks that's the best scene, honestly. Like, I mean, like, it's... While it's not necessarily realistic, I mean, like shooting that Tommy, shooting that gun, that machine,
that
Tommy
precision,
gun, yeah,
those things worth
the dude. The precision from the precision, distance,
like with a Tommy gun.
This is
dude,
the
that
perfect
thing's a
example.
Lawnmower. That thing is a lawnmower.
Yeah, but the accuracy,
right?
This is yeah, the yeah, yeah. This is a perfect yeah. Example of cinema altering reality to something that it shouldn't be, maybe.
But
like,
it works.
But it works thematically, and it works. He kills off his crew. He doesn't hit him at all. He comes up behind him and like, if you're about to die, are you going to say those words? Are you going to say, you know, I'm just glad it was you? No, but it
not
works.
Not necessarily.
But
no.
It works.
Right.
And you can see the hurt in Tom Hanks'
because
eyes
too. It's a fucking movie and these people are speaking what they're feeling. You know what
yeah.
I'm saying? Like, this is how movies work.
So it's about.
They're reality heightened, okay? And like, I think people lose sight of that when like cinema sins and people like that, fuck them. Pieces of shit. All they can do is like point out like what's wrong with a movie. What about what's right with a movie, man?
CinemaSins. Fuck you.
Fuck you, CinemaSins.
CinemaSins
you're everything
too,
that's
huh?
Wrong. You're everything that's wrong with you know critics basically.
Fuck critics that are not us.
Anyway.
Dude, that's fuck us too,
that's
bro.
That's
not fuck us, unfuck us.
Hey, I'm known for giving higher scores, okay?
Right.
I appreciate this shit, but...
You're like the most appreciative... Like, you haven't been
but
that
people,
low.
People will actually. Fucking... They will harp on shit like that. They'll be like,
yeah.
He wouldn't say that, and well, he's right. About to die.
He would have died too.
It's like, bro, fuck off, man. Like, he's a character speaking
right.
His truth in the moment, okay? It's what you wish you could say at the time.
Like I said, if it was an anime, motherfuckers would be like... Accurate.
Exactly.
Facts.
The weebs would be about it.
All
the
you
weebs
would
be
like,
about it.
Oh, so you took down my crew. Oh.
Oh.
But when you have that camera pan back and you see his goons get shot up and then he's left standing there holding the fucking car door.
That's.
And like, I mean, it's right by the characters, man. That's what matters first and foremost. And he comes around, he turns around. Like I said, you see the sorrow and the regret and the...
Turmoil.
No
conflict.
Regrets.
Like, you see all the fucking everything in his eyes.
The hurt.
And that's Paul Newman
yes.
Fucking doing what Paul Newman fucking does.
Facts.
And then you got Tom Hanks doing the same thing, but he's slightly more angry, and he's got to get his revenge.
Definitely a lot less yeah. Forrest-y.
Question.
Yeah, you see Forrest. He's upset. Okay.
Question.
If it was Forrest Gump, that'd be Lieutenant Dan. He should have done.
Forrest was that. First of all, Alabama should have never lost to LSU in that game.
Right. Fuck that.
They should have put him out at kick returner.
Unwatchable.
Question.
This movie is fake as fuck.
Is Tom Hanks our Paul Newman?
Nah.
There would never be another Paul Newman.
Nah.
Is he the closest to it?
Maybe that's him handing it off to him, too.
Shout out to the Joe.
I'm glad it was you.
The Joe says he is Paul Newman.
Who?
The Joe.
All right.
The Joe says Paul Newman is me. That's what he says.
Joe. All right. That's a
shout out to the Joe. The other Paul Newman, apparently.
It's not narcissistic at all.
What's your score, brother?
I'm going to say, first of all, underrated as fuck.
Yes.
Might be the most underrated movie of our time.
I don't know our time, but nobody, one of Tom Hanks' most underrated.
A lot of people
sure.
don't know about this movie.
Nobody talks about it.
No.
And when you brought it up, all I can remember was Tom Hanks, Paul Newman.
Yeah.
What movie? Some great movie had to have come out that time for it to like get overlooked as far as like an Oscar run and shit.
Holy shit, though. Like you rewatch it and you're like, how did this not...
It's such a solid movie from
like,
every
how
angle.
How did this not kill it that year?
Yeah.
But...
So
it's one of the best like gangster movies.
So my score will definitely be like it's super high. It's fucking.
What is it?
I'm gonna say, and you might get on me about. I thought it was tonally a little off with the levity. I'm gonna say 9.7 out of 10.
Whoa!
Yeah,
all
right.
Whoa!
I love it, man.
All right. Here's why it happened. The Pianist. The Lord of the Rings, The Two Towers, Frida, and Chicago all came out that year.
Yeah.
First of all, Pianist was fantastic.
Pianist was great. But
Road to Perdition should have been up there with the other ones. Over Lord of the Rings and over Chicago.
It's all that other shit that came out. Like, had this movie come out a year earlier, or had they sat on it for a couple years later, it would have fucking bombed.
Here's the thing. True. Yeah, if it wouldn't have went up against the first Lord of the Rings, it might have had a fighting chance. But you're going into a sequel to a movie that... hit harder than most people thought it was going to.
Yeah,
but except Road to Perdition was a sleeper title.
Right, exactly. I mean, because you're going up against a sequel of one of the biggest fantasy movies of like all time at that time.
Wait, and
like,
I think also Gangs of New York came out that time too.
Oh, fuck. God. Yeah. I never seen it, but I know that movie is apparently fucking
phenomenal. Pianist was fantastic, though.
Fucking
yeah,
also,
a good movie.
Also fucking Spirited Away came out, dude. So like this shit was loaded.
Yeah. Fucking
this
Spirited
shit
Away.
Was loaded.
That's one of the big ones.
It was a good year for movies, though.
Yeah.
Right? Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you guys for sticking with us through all the crazy bullshit.
Yep, Gangs of New York came out that same year, dude. So there was no fucking way it had a shot. Because fucking Sam Mendes was still a fucking rookie back then. Yeah. They're like,
one of the most underrated directors.
Yep.
Big facts. So, ladies and gentlemen, there you have it. It is time for our picks. Jofer wasn't here for the last episode, so we're going to obviously give him a pick.
I was trying to go lighthearted this time around because we did some dark movies the last two episodes.
I guess we're going to go fucking around the table. Chuck, you'll get another pick, and Red will get another pick. Jofer, go ahead first.
All right, so I know you wanted something light, so I'm going to give you guys a choice. All right, they're both on Netflix. I'm either going to give you The Town, or I'm going to give you, The Town, yeah. Well, I'm sorry, but like it's
Butterflies and Roses.
That's
and
our version. That's our version of light, right?
Or that, or I'm gonna give you
as light as we go.
Or I'm gonna give you guys a documentary, a Drive to Survive. It's all about F1, and it's eight episodes.
He's a hater of documentaries.
We'd have to do half and half. Probably.
Yeah, half and half.
No,
you know what? I'm gonna go for it. No. That's what I'm doing it.
Show host veto. No.
No more
no documentaries.
No more TV.
No more documentaries.
No more documentaries. Just no more documentaries. Shows, yes.
Documentaries are hard to
look.
To,
I will do based on true, mm-hmm. like Bad Education, Pain and Gain. Mm-hmm. We'll do based on truths, but documentaries, literally, did you learn something? All right, you give it a fucking 9. Have a nice day.
They're different. It's hard to.
I mean,
it shot well? Was it informative? Did it have good music? Like, you can't really do much with it. We can break down acting styles. We can break down cinematography. We can break down the writing. We can break down what it means.
Documentaries have their own.
Here it is. Here you go.
Well,
I mean, I'll admit from asking
factual.
For a score.
We're more theatrical than factual.
Right. It's exactly. You have factual. It's basically.
You want to flip that, maybe?
That's the only way you can. Really break it down.
We can do things based off of real stories. Yeah.
And shout out to the Joe one more time. He says, Chicago was amazing. You plebs deserved best picture. Shout out to the Joe.
All
right, then you guys have Hulu.
He probably did.
I have Hulu, yeah.
Yeah.
All right, then fuck it. I'll do Buffaloed.
Buffaloed.
Okay.
All right. Sounds good.
We're
going
to go back to the 90s. We're going to do The Birdcage.
All right. Good call. All right.
Wow.
All right.
And then
it's
Red.
On my list.
Man, I got to take a dark.
Jesus Christ.
Dude, dark comedy, I'm cool with that.
Mine's more of like a fucking great comedy.
We're not doing Chicago.
Watching Road to Perdition, the father-son relationship, and it had a lot to say about that. And so I'm going to go even further, and I'm going to do Ad Astra on HBO Max.
All right.
Or HBO.
That's a movie?
Yes.
Yeah, that's Brad Pitt.
It's a Brad Pitt movie.
All right.
It was in my top 10 last year.
Wait, all right. Let me recall my pick then. How about I'll give you guys Buffaloed or Ford versus Ferrari?
I'll do Ford versus Ferrari.
But what is that on, though?
HBO. But
Ford versus.
I got the hookup.
As long as you don't mind.
Yeah. All right. So we're solidifying it right now. What are you doing?
All right. Ford versus Ferrari. Ford, they won Ford versus Ferrari.
I will say beforehand, Ad Astra, it will be divisive. There will be.
Divisive.
Divisive. There will be people that in this room that do not appreciate it, I don't think. And that's why I'm picking it.
You looking at me this way again?
I was going for something lighter hearted that's just going to make us all laugh. You know,
the Birdcage. Yeah.
So we're going to go to the Birdcage. I'm going to pick.
I love Birdcage, by the way.
So, yeah, Ford versus Ferrari for me.
I don't see any connection between these, but okay. All right.
We'll find one.
We'll get there.
Ad Astra. Because
we got to have.
Brad Pitt. HBO Max.
And I'm going to set this up now ahead of time because we're already, getting midway through fucking July. So the first episode in August, we're going to be doing Scott Pilgrim. That episode will be, we're going to do either comic book to film or video game to film.
Except there's no good video game movies, though.
Yeah, there's not.
I mean, there's really not, but we're still going to do it.
Mario or something?
No.
Yeah. Fucking Resident Evil.
We could do Resident Evil. We could do Sonic. We could do...
Sonic's probably going to be plenty of other ones. Yeah.
But we'll do that on that episode.
What about Hardcore Henry? That's not a video game movie, but it's...
It might as well be video game.
Damn, that is close.
That is a good movie, though.
But that's something to look for.
Did you guys do Ready Player One already?
Not yet.
We can do that.
You know they're making a Ready Player Two?
Yeah.
The book's dropping, I think, in a month.
Boom. We're going to definitely do that because also I want to do another. Oh, we haven't done fucking like Kung Fu. Like, what the fuck? Like, there's so many great Kung Fu action films.
Oh.
Like, Eat Mon 4.
Kung Pao.
Kung Pao.
You like Kung Pao?
Dude.
I love that movie.
Fucking Kung Fu Hustle.
Kung Fu Hustle's great.
So cute.
Fucking Shaolin Soccer.
I almost picked Kung Fu Hustle. I thought about it.
You know what I'm saying? And then actually good, like, legit Kung Fu.
Dude, I went to Kung Pao and saw it in the theater, and literally my crew, it was me and Blake and...
Mm-hmm. Corn dogs!
I want to say Mike. We were
360.
The only ones laughing in there. Everybody else was fucking like, what is this stupid shit? And we were howling laughing.
I laughed so hard I cried several times in that movie.
But yeah, so we're going to have some more... focal pointed picks in the
themes. We're gonna have some themes.
I'd like to change my pick.
You are?
Yeah. Right. Shaun of the Dead.
All right.
Whoa! Good pick.
All right, so I gotta remove this from the group chat.
I already copied and pasted Birdcage.
I'm just gonna remove for everyone. So Ford versus Ferrari.
It's fine. Mm-hmm. I'll make do.
Ford versus Ferrari. We got Ad Astrica, Asterix, whatever, with Brad Pitt.
Ad Astra.
Ad Blocker, whatever.
And I can predict that like half of y'all are going to be like, what the fuck is that?
Ad Astra, and then you just switched it up to...
Shaun of the Dead.
Shaun of the Dead. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to go to close it out. Joe, for any last final words,
As always, stay hydrated so we don't thirst for these hoes. Black Lives Matter, all that good shit. Fuck GameStop. All
right, down with GameStop.
What the
Chuck.
Fuck was that?
I want to give another music recommendation. This album came back out in 2000, or back in like February. It's one of my favorite bands. They're called Intronaut.
Okay.
The album's called Fluid Existential Inversions. It is my album of the year so far. It is fucking fantastic.
All right.
They're kind of like progressive post-metal with like these nice jazzy parts and...
Good deal.
It's so fucking good.
Metal. All right.
Give it a nice like 45 minutes, 50 minutes to listen to it. Amazing.
All right.
All right.
Drop that in the idea chat, man. I want to check it out.
Red.
Shout out to Yuri.
Aww.
Shout out to Yuri.
I love you, Yuri.
Aww. What a tender moment.
And I just had to say that.
That was sweet.
Hey, Browns fan, shut the fuck up.
Hey.
All
right.
That's all I got to say. Shut the fuck up, Sergio. I'll come over there.
Wow. All right, ladies and gentlemen. I want to thank y'all for tuning in. Those that have tuned in dropped in and jumped out and all that. Appreciate all the views and all that. Jump over to our DeFool and Friends page. Like that shit. We got big things coming in the future. Trust me. You're going to be... Stay with us. It's going to be Surgeon General, any last words before we get out of here, sir?
Nope.
No?
Not any shout-outs, anybody?
Nothing.
Nothing? All righty. You got a music track ready to go?
Nope.
Actually, you still got the Scott Pilgrim? You got Threshold?
Yep.
Throw that on there.
Sure.
Please like and share. Spread the word.
Yeah. And we are going to do... honestly, we are going to do a viewer choice, and Chicago will be on there for you fucking Joe, all right? But it won't be soon. It will be in the future.
What about Avatar The Last Airbender cartoon series?
That's so fucking long, man.
It's still a fucking dope series.
It is. I'm not saying it's not.
It's like three seasons, right?
Yeah.
We're going to have to do it season by season. Then.
Right.
Yeah. And the thing is that each season's like 20 episodes.
Right, exactly. Oh, that's why I'm like,
yeah, but they're like 20 minutes, 23 minutes.
Right.
That's a long. Your face is 20 minutes.
Your face is 25 minutes.
Well, oh.
Hey, y'all, calm the fuck down.
On that caveat, though, if we do that, whoever picks it, whoever's putting it up.
Say that about each other.
That's your pick for that five episodes.
Yeah.
But all right, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to have a viewer's choice in the future here soon, shortly, in the near future.
Like Nickelodeon.
So keep it in mind. Throw us some suggestions. But as always, Bo the Fool, Kappa Well, I want to thank y'all for tuning in, liking, sharing, subscribing, all that shit. Love it. I really appreciate y'all. Serge,
thank
you good?
Y'all.
We love you.
You ready, Serge?
Sure.
You ready? Thank y'all. We out.
Bust
appreciate
that shit.
Y'all. Bo the Fool, Kappa Well, I love y'all. Peace.